This afternoon, from the Bob Carpenter Center, the University of Delaware Blue Hens take on the College of Charleston Cougars. Hello, everyone, and welcome to Newark, Delaware. I'm Scott Klatskin. Today, the Hens start off the second half of the CAA schedule against a team they've already beaten once down in Charleston. We are a day away from the last month of the season, and let's take a look at how this wide-open conference has played out in the month of January. As you can see at the top of the standings, a team that Delaware has already beaten once and a team that, well, they probably should have beaten on the road down at Trask Coliseum. William & Mary and UNCW at 7-2. As we move down, the team that many thought was the best squad in the league, Hofstra, has been struggling as of late, losers of two games in a row. They're 5-4, and the rest of the gang, Drexel, Elon, Towson, Delaware, and College of Charleston, all trying to fight to avoid that bye in the CAA tournament down in Baltimore. Delaware, coming off a loss against James Madison, 88-82, their second loss in a row, but Delaware has won three of their last six games, and three straight games, Delaware has hit the 80-point mark, although the last two, they have fallen to James Madison and Elon. In that game against the Dukes, Marvin King Davis had a career night with 31 points. Marvin King Davis in that contest became the first UD forward to score 30 points since Harding Nana did it, 31 points against Old Dominion back in February of 2006. The big man is only one of five UD forwards to score 30 points in a game in the last 20 seasons, joining Mike Pegues, Nana, Pekka Arsic, and Greg Smith. King Davis has been on fire as of late, shooting 61% from the field over the last four games. He leads the team with over five rebounds per contest. Charleston comes into the game led by Canyon Berry. The sophomore was named to the 2014 CAA All-Rookie and All-Academic teams after playing 24 games as a redshirt freshman. And this year as a sophomore, no sophomore slump. He leads the team in points, steals, three-pointers made, blocked shots, and three-point field goal percentage. Also second on the team with over five rebounds per contest. And when you go to the free throw line and you're a Berry, you shoot underhand. He does it just like his father, Rick, who ranks number three in NBA history in free throw shooting percentage at almost 90%. We're going to have tip-off in just a few minutes. I'll have the call with my broadcast partner, Bill Harmon, on 94.7 WDSD and here on Hens All Access. But first, before the Hens tip off with the Cougars, we'll send it over to public address announcer, Kevin Linton.
Please direct your attention to center court and welcome Blue Hens men's basketball B positive hero, Matt Hayes. Matt is accompanied by his parents, Cheryl and Wayne. Matt is a survivor of acute lymphocytic leukemia, who was in treatment for 38 months, but has been in remission for over 7 years. A fifth grade honor roll student at William Henry Middle School. Matt enjoys playing basketball, video games, and bike riding. Blue Hens head coach Monte Ross is presenting Matt with his own personal Blue Hens locker room nameplate. Let's have a great big Blue Hens round of applause for the Be Positive hero, Matt Hayes. And welcome to Blue Hens basketball. Time, fans, we do ask that you please rise to help us honor America. And out of respect to our nation, the United States of America, please remove your caps and headwear. Here performing their rendition of our national anthem, please welcome the University of Delaware Pep Band.
Thank you.
Ladies and gentlemen, at this time, let's meet today's starting lineups. First, as we welcome and introduce the visiting College of Charleston Cougars. And introducing first, a guard, a 6'4 freshman of Athens, Georgia, number 12, Cameron Johnson. At guard, a 6'3 sophomore of Orlando, Florida, number 13, Joe Cheeley. At forward, a 6'7 sophomore of Norcross, Georgia, number 15, Terrence O'Donohue. At guard, a 6'6 sophomore of Colorado Springs, Colorado, number 24, Kenyon Barry. And at forward, a 6'9 senior out of Abidjan, Ivory Coast, number 1, Ajay Baru. Coaches here for College of Charleston, Director of Basketball Operations, J.D. Powell, Assistant Coaches are Dick Bender, Antonio Reynolds D, Quinton Farrell. Ladies and gentlemen, his first season at the College of Charleston, the head coach, Earl Grant. And now, ladies and gentlemen,
Martelli in his fourth and Chris Cheeks in his third leading the Blue Hens. They'll go with Corey Holden, the freshman, currently the CAA Rookie of the Week for the third time, 4.7 assists per game, leads the team in that category, eighth in the NCAA amongst freshman guards. At the two-guard position, Kasman Hayes, he had 12 points and 5 offense rebounds against the College of Charleston last time these two teams met. Kyle Anderson is the third guard. The senior stands 6'3", 10 points last game. He's been in double figures 12 of 13 games this season. Marvin King Davis is the power forward, 31 points last game on 10 of 17 from the field. And the man in the middle, Maurice Jeffers, is 6'9", 240-pound sophomore from Washington, D.C. Just 2 points in 11 minutes against James Madison. Delaware comes out in their home white uniforms with the blue numbers. College of Charleston comes out with the maroon road jerseys with the gold numbers and the white trim Charleston across the chest. Delaware go left to right away from their bench to start. Charleston going right to left away from their bench to begin this first half of action. Baru at 6'9", Jeffers at 6'9" to jump it off, and Jeffers wins the tip. We are underway here at the Bob Carpenter Center. Delaware leads the all-time series 3-2 over the Cougars.
Charleston typically plays a lot of man-to-man defense. Coach Grant trying to make his impression on his team. Let's be a great defensive team first.
Hayes to Anderson on the curl. Inside to Jeffers. We've seen games start this way before. Jeffers working to his left and gets it to go. How many times have we seen Mo Jeffers or Marvin King Davis score the first bucket on the inside?
Right block. Goes into the middle, which is exactly what he should do. Uses that left-hand jump hook. Baru just not that intense defensively to try to challenge that shot. A good start here for Delaware.
And you know what? That's been the knock on the scouting report against Baru. Lacks intensity out there on the floor. All the talent in the world. as Charleston works the ball around the perimeter and inside to O'Donohue. He misses from the right side, poked around and grabbed by Corey Holden along the baseline. He gets it across half court, skips, passes to Hayes. Hayes corner three off the mark. Back tap by Jeffers, but taking it is Cameron Johnson. Johnson down the floor into the paint and draws contact plus the foul for Cam Johnson. First on Kyle Anderson, and the freshman from Athens will go to the stripe to try to finish off the three-point play.
After doing a great job defensively at one end, Mo Jeffers came across and double-teamed to Donohue to force that miss. Down at the other end, he had an opportunity for the rebound, couldn't quite get his body there, and then relied on the back tap. But unfortunately, it was picked off immediately and pushed, and many times that back tap, that happens and allows Anderson to pick up an early foul and also College of Charleston to get out in transition.
Johnson misses the free throw, though. 71% on the season. Can't connect there. It's Anderson inside to Jeffers. Right block again. Guarded by Baru. Baru knocks it away on the reach in. Jeffers gets it back too strong from the right block. And back to Charleston it goes.
Baru could have easily gotten a foul there. Mo Jeffers did a good job kind of recovering on the ball there. But his shot comes out of his hand a little flat, and that resulted in the miss.
Johnson has it for the College. 2-2's the count. Minute 30 into the contest here at the Bob Carpenter Center. Delaware 3-6 in the conference, trying to get a win against the Cougars as they did back on January 10th. Good ball movement. Goes right to left, back to the right. A cutting. Johnson has all four of the College's points. It's 4-2.
Cameron Johnson doing a nice job off the ball in terms of his movement. Kasman Hayes got bumped and then had his head turned. Did not see the ball being thrown. A nice set there run by College of Charleston.
It's an assist for Ajay Baru, and on top it goes to Jeffers for Delaware. Holden, left side, one dribble inside of Marvin King Davis. Fading baseline, too strong. Anderson tries to grab the rebound, cannot haul it in, but that's because he was fouled by the College of Charleston. Their first foul.
Even though Marvin King Davis missed that fall away on the left side, that is his shot. I've watched him practice that shot time and time again. The angle's tough, but he creates separation. That's a good look for him. And Kyle Anderson, nice job on the weak side. Offensive rebound block.
And as Delaware inbounds it, one of the traits I like best about Marvin King Davis is rarely do we see him take a shot that isn't his shot. 26 on the shot clock as Holden gets bumped by O'Donohue. Couldn't keep up as Holden tried to turn the corner. Second foul in his possession against the College of Charleston. That first foul was called against Canyon Berry, and now the first on O'Donohue.
Pretty clever play there by Corey Holden. As he came off the screen, he got bumped by O'Donohue, and he kind of acted it out, and that created the foul, something that Curry did the other night to have Jeffers pick up a foul.
Inside, King Davis off the entry from Kyle Anderson. Ball goes out of bounds, last touch by the Cougars. It'll stay with Delaware, 27 on the shot clock. Hens down by 4-2, and 17:32 left in the first.
I like the matchup with Marvin King Davis against O'Donohue. O'Donohue is playing in place of Gilmore. He had an excellent game against Towson.
Yeah, they really like the way O'Donohue has been progressing, although he did not play well against Delaware. No points in 14 minutes back on January 10th, or the last several games. He's been showing much improvement, the sophomore from Georgia. Jeffers, a ball fake to Anderson, and Cheely just going too fast, ran into Anderson after the pump fake. And that's the third foul on this possession for the College of Charleston this time. It's Cheely who picks up his first.
Kyle Anderson, very clever, coming off the down screen. He had the defender closing him out, Cheely, and he used the ball fake to get him up in the air, and that resulted in the foul. Very smart play by Kyle Anderson.
Another reset shot clock for Delaware. Holden brings it to the left side. Gilmore quickly into the game on a substitution for College of Charleston. Jeffers to Holden. Holden strong. Anderson an offensive rebound. In the paint, off the window. Good for Kyle Anderson, who got the offensive board and the second chance point.
We talk about what a great three-point shooter Kyle Anderson is, how he's worked on his game in the mid-range and with that floater, but now he's working the offensive glass, doing a great job here, continuing to add variety to his game.
Now Cheely, a pull-up Jay at the top of the circle from that foul line just above. Now a lob down the floor running is King Davis, but he can't get to it. Good idea, just an errant pass as Holden led him a little too far along the baseline. First turnover for the Hens.
You're right. I like the fact that Delaware tries to get something out of their bigs running rim to rim. I think if Corey had seen that one step sooner, he could have delivered the ball instead of forcing Marvin out of bounds.
First turnover for Holden, who's been so good over the past several games. As Cheely drives in, tough angle and got it to go, driving inside with his right hand. 8-4 is the count, Charleston up.
Delaware chose not to hedge at all on that ball screen there by Baru, and that freed up Cheely to get in the lane. Jeffers just couldn't get there in time to affect the shot.
16-12 remaining in the first half. Jeffers left alone at the foul line. Gets it to Anderson. Anderson couldn't grip the basketball as he goes inside. It's poked away by Gilmore. Now Canyon Berry with it. Hayes giving chase, but a bounce pass to Cameron Johnson finishes the play. He's got six of the Cougars' 10, and they lead by six.
Berry showing what a well-rounded player he is, just like his father. Did a good job of drawing the defense to him and then delivered a perfect bounce pass.
Canyon Berry, the son of former NBA All-Star Rick Berry. Holding gets inside, missing strong off the glass, and a rebound by Gilmore off the bench. Ahead to Johnson again. This time gets in the paint, comes back out to Brew, and settles to Canyon Berry on the left side. His pass to Brew, left block, goes to Gilmore. Gilmore, I think, thought there was a player in the corner that pass might have been targeting. Let it go out of bounds, and a turnover after the miscommunication. We'll take a break. 10-4 is the early lead for the College of Charleston. 15:30 left in the first.
Hey fans, 12 and younger, do you want to be a future Blue Hen? Join the Future Hens Club presented by St. Francis Healthcare for invites to exclusive events and free admission to select UD games.
Meet coaches and players like us.
Get your official Future Hens t-shirt and more surprises.
To join, log on bluehens.com with a parent, click on Fan Zone, then Kids Club. Click Register Here, fill out your information, and click Submit.
Join today!
We have the pieces. Now it's time to bring them together. Every dribble and every rep turns into every point and every win. It's winning time again. Experience it.
Delaware, Scott Klatskin, Bill Harmon here, broadcasting live from the Value Days broadcast table, presented by Exxon and Shell. Download the Dash In app by texting WDSD to 55123. 10-4 is the count. College of Charleston on top early. 15:30 left in the first half. The college has made each of their last five shots, and eight of their 10 points have come inside the paint.
Well, when you're able to get into the lane as easily as College of Charleston is doing, you're going to shoot a high percentage. Delaware's got to do a better job with the hedge of the high ball screen, and then they've got to level out these defenders and also sag in from the weak side and provide another body in the lane to distract a dribbler as he gets in there.
Delaware has the basketball coming out of the media timeout. O'Donohue back in. He's with Gilmore. Baru out of the ball game for College Charleston. Chile, Johnson, and Berry round out the crew for the Cougars. Starters still on the floor for Delaware as some full court pressure comes. Hayes gets it across and gets it back to Holden. He'll stand at the Blue Hen logo, center circle. King Davis gets it on the elbow, right side. Flashing baseline was Anderson. Couldn't get it to him. Now Holden, left-handed pass to Hayes in the corner. He's 0 of 2 now from 3. Long rebound in the hands of Johnson. He wants to push. Does not have numbers on the right side and will slow things up to a teammate, Cheely.
I think College of Charleston is taking a book out of Drexel's defensive plan. Kenyon Berry guarding Holden, that 6'6 frame versus Allen, who was 6'7, trying to affect some of his shots.
That's what Tavon Allen did. You're absolutely right against Drexel. Held Holden in check for the most part. Long three missed by Cheely. First miss in six tries for College of Charleston, but an offensive rebound. Their first O-rep, and they keep possession up by six.
Not a great offensive rebounding team, but those long rebounds, the guards have to help out. Defend the defensive glass.
Now Johnson throws it across the court, stolen away by Kasman Hayes. Now Anderson, quick release on the three, missing. Berry pokes it to himself, knocked away by Jeffers. It'll be College of Charleston basketball.
Now that's a good play by Kasman Hayes. He's got our best three-point shooter running the right wing. He got it in a perfect spot, rose up. That is a good shot. Sometimes the good shots don't get in, and we'll talk about shots that are bad shots that do. But if Delaware continues to get out in transition and give players like Kyle Anderson those looks, they're going to have a great afternoon.
16th steal of the season for Kasman Hayes. He leads the team in that category. He's first today. Hens shooting 2 of 9 to start, while the college 5 of 7. They lead by 6. Bailey in the game. That's Evan Bailey, a freshman from Ohio. Gets a touch. Over to Chile. Stops, bounce pass. Power dribble O'Donohue taken away by Javarski Corbett. Anderson on the ground, loses it to Berry. Berry a three ball left side. That's off the mark, and Corbett gets the defensive rebound.
Barry a little slow to get that shot off. It was right from the start.
Now Anderson, a deep three from the right side, missing again as he did last possession from nearly the same spot. Knocked out of bounds in, I believe, Delaware basketball, as Chile could not hold on to the long miss.
Mo Jeffers did a nice job there on the offensive glass. He contested it, which sometimes is not a good idea, but the ball was in between. It got tipped. And then as the ball was going out of bounds, he followed in case the ball was going to be saved. He was in perfect position. A smart play by Mo Jeffers.
And Jeffers been very active so far. And here we are, 6 minutes plus into the game. No fouls for Mo, just like you asked for. Inbound goes to Holden. Holden yet to score. 4 points for Delaware. They trail 10-4. Holden, a couple crossovers on O'Donohue. Back to Corbett. Corbett getting inside, leaning off balance, back iron, took a second hop, and then came off the rim into the hands of Evan Bailey for Charleston.
Unfortunately, Shabarsky Corbett was sliding a little hard to his right. That did not allow him to get the ball over the front of the rim.
Barry this time a step in from three-point land, and that one goes through. 12-4 now the count after that two-point make from Barry.
That was a ball screen on the side with Baru, and again, Mo Jeffers probably needs to come out and be a little bit more aggressive to allow Anderson some help as he gets picked.
Delaware struggling offensively, down by eight, early 7 minutes in here at the Bob. Inside to King Davis. He has good position. Fades and hits Marvin King Davis right where he left off in Harrisonburg, Virginia, scoring and getting to the free throw line where he was 11 of 13 against the Dukes.
So many times we talk about the intelligent entry pass, and it was a very good one, but that work was done by Marvin King Davis prior to that. He did a great job of rolling off a screen. Then he worked his body to the other side, sealed the defender behind him, and then rose up with a turnaround shot. That was great off-the-ball movement by Marvin King Davis to set himself up for a very close shot.
Brew coming in as O'Donohue picks up his second foul there against Marvin King Davis. Fourth on College of Charleston, and King Davis finishes the play with the free throw. Delaware now trails 12-7. Pinkard will come in. Marvin to the bench. Pinkard, Corbett, Jeffers, Anderson, Holden on the floor.
Well, Pinkard's in getting this early rotation that he's earned by playing so well. Let's look for him to help a little bit more on some of these screens and off the ball.
Pinkard averaging 3 rebounds per game. He's played well defensively, and that's the foul you got to avoid as Jeffers, beyond the three-point arc against the ball handler, trying to hedge on a screen, picks up his first.
Now, Mo was out early. He just needs to stand there. If he stands there down low in his stance, that will not be a foul, but he was still moving, and that's where the draw came. But still a pretty good job playing almost 7 minutes plus without a foul.
Second foul on Delaware. First on Mo. Baru now right block working against Mo Jeffers. Jeffers standing tall. Baru in trouble. Has to fade away off the back of the iron, and it falls through for Ajay Baru. 14-7. College of Charleston on top.
Baru did a good job maintaining his poise there, as Pinkard did a nice job helping out, forcing Baru to pull up a little short of where he wanted, but he was able to make the shot using the backboard.
Anderson working hard to try to get the basketball. Squares, fires up a three, and that one's good. Baru was caught in no man's land, too far away to get a hand up against Anderson, and he makes a big man pay.
Well, if you do switch off on Kyle Anderson, you better make him become a dribbler. That time he recognized that Baru was on him and soft off of him, did a great job of rising up. That's the kind of shot that I know Anderson is very capable of making.
He's done it 250 times now as a Blue Hen in his career. Barry trying to answer with a three of his own, missing. Jeffers taps it to Pinkard. Pinkard running up the floor, looks for a guard and finds Holden with the Hens down by four. Holden taking his man off the dribble to the rim. Shot blocked. Baru came over to help. His ninth block of the season, gets it for Charleston. Now Chile up the floor. Left sideline. Hesitation dribble coming across. And shot blocked by Corbett on the other end. Ball loose. And a reach is going to be called against Charleston with 11:28 left in the first half. And Delaware, which trailed by eight, now down just four. We'll take a break on 94.7 WDSD. Back in a moment.
Hello, Delaware fans. This is Coach Brock at beautiful Lums Pond State Park, just minutes from Delaware Stadium. I'm inviting you to come to the park, enjoy their year-round camping, boat rentals, equestrian center, and so much more. While you're here, experience the Go Ape Treetop Adventure. Go Ape is an outdoor experience where you can live life adventurously and experience the park from 50 feet up in the trees, hanging by a wire. To learn more about Go Ape or to book your visit to the course, visit www.goape.com. Go Hens!
Hold on to me as we go. Just know you're not alone. 'Cause I'm gonna make this place your home. Oh, 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 oh.
Welcome back to the Bob Carpenter Center, where Delaware trails by 4, 14-10. One of our listeners at a portion of today's broadcast on 94.7 WDSD is powered by Brandywine Electronics. Visit BEL.com. And Brandywine Electronics, of course, if you're down by the Polar Bear Plunge, they provide all the audio there for that great cause as well down in downstate Delaware. So they're all over the place.
Have you ever done a polar bear challenge?
I have not. Have you?
Absolutely not.
Well, then we'll stay warm here inside.
I am not nearly tough enough to do that.
The friendly confines.
I like being inside in the warmth.
Yeah, the Bob Carpenter Sir, Joe Dombrowski, though, doing a great. He always wants to get me in that water, but I'm busy. I got a game to call today. Thanks to the Blue Hens for my out. 14-10 is the count. Hens trailed by 8 now. A chance to cut it within 2 or 1 here on this possession. Anderson, 1-3 in this game, 250th career. Pass inside to Eric Carter, working hard on Brew. Up, too strong off the window is Eric Carter. Brew, good defense, and back to Charleston it goes.
That was a nice find by Kyle Anderson from the top. Eric Carter will score a lot. I love the fact they're willing to give it in there to him.
Barry, nifty move to slice through and get the floater up with the right hand. Back up to 6 is the lead for Charleston.
Kenyon Barry took advantage of Eric Carter overshowing there. He's got to be a little closer to the screener not to allow the split to happen.
Force pass inside by Anderson, knocked away. Another turnover for Delaware. They only had 5 in the entire game against James Madison. That's their third. Here's Barry, step back over Corbett. Barry feeling good. And lead back up to 8 with 4 straight from Canyon after the timeout.
Not only is he in rhythm, he used his body that time to get Corbett off of him. A little bump, Corbett dropped back, too late to close off. Very smart offense by Canyon Barry.
Very good shooter is Canyon Barry. As Holden drives, gets from left to right with some nifty ball handling, but misses on the layup. He's now 0-4 is Holden, out of bounds to College of Charleston.
Scott, I think at times Corey gets a little fast and maybe a little too deep early on in the game where the lane is still packed. I'd love to see him get into around the CAA logo, pick the ball up, and then kick it back out to a Pinkard, an Anderson, a Hayes out on the perimeters. They use a crackback technique. It's great to attack, and you've got to do that some. But if you do it too much, that's what the defense is looking for.
And perhaps that's a conversation on the bench as Holden will get a breather. Mosley into the game. We've seen Holden have slow starts. Remember the William and Mary game where he didn't play well in the first half and then dominated in that second half to get the victory over the Tribe. But right now, Delaware down by 8. Johnson getting deep inside. Carter blocks the shot out of bounds. And with 16 seconds left on the ticker, it'll stay with the Cougars.
Unfortunately, Delaware right now has allowed the ball to enter the lane way too often. And if it enters the lane, it's got to enter where there's help available. If it comes in around the CA logo vertically, they're going to have trouble.
Inbound goes to Johnson on the right side. Pat Brannon into the game. With Anthony Stitt injured, he's been injured the last 6 contests. Pat Brannon is the next man up off the bench. Limited 14 games this season, but getting his minutes up over the last several. 2 seconds on the shot clock. Gilmore has to fade away. Nearly goes in after hitting the back iron. Took a high hop, but bounced off into the hands of Pinkard. Here's Mosley. Mosley's got to be careful with the basketball and slow down the pace.
Good coaching by you. You're absolutely right.
I was getting nervous as he got his worked his way towards the three-point arc and a whistle away from the ball.
Some physical play there. Eric Carter trying to post up, and he caught the defender underneath him, and a nice call by this crew.
Foul goes against Glenn Pierre Jr., the sophomore, standing 6'11". That's his first and the 5th now on the College of Charleston with 9:30 left in the first half. Pinkard got to throw it into somebody. Jump ball for Javarski, nearly goes back at court and does so. Ball stolen away by Chile. Not a good inbound pass there by Pinkard, and Corbett did not handle it correctly. Now on the other end, College of Charleston gets a steal and a bucket. A 10-point advantage for the Cougars, up 20-10 in a timeout by Monte Ross. Will stay right here.
That's why you never want to have the ball entered right at the timeline. Just go into the backcourt. There's no issue there. You can throw it all the way down to the other end if you want. You've got to kind of know the rules and know the situation. Part of the problem was on the inbound play, Kyle Anderson was trying to set a back screen for Eric Carter, and they allowed the Charleston defender to literally run over Anderson. Those two ended up on the right side. Delaware had no safety available as they threw it in deep. That's when the turnover resulted.
Right now, Delaware down by their largest margin in the first half. 6 points for Johnson, 6 for Chile, 6 for Barry to lead the way for the Cougars thus far. For Delaware, Anderson has 5, 3 for King Davis, and 2 for Jeffers. The only scorers is Delaware shooting 4 of 16 from the field, while the College of Charleston, same amount of shots, but They've made six more of them. They're 10 of 16, shooting 63%. Full court man-to-man defense here by College Charleston. They get it into Mosley, do the Hens after the timeout. Pinker going to bring the ball up the floor. Gilmore defends as he gets it across the timer. Trying to get to Mosley. Good defense by Chile denying it. Pinkard behind the back dribble brings it back out. He'll settle. 22 on the shot clock. Still have not been able to find the point guard Mosley. Here's Pinkard now picking up his dribble and a pass inside to Javarski Corbett. Delaware helped out on that possession by a reach and foul against the Cougars, and we're going to have to see Holden back in. They trying to get him some minutes of rest, but it's tough to do.
Well, Chile did a wonderful job of face guarding Anthony Mosley, just wouldn't allow him to get the ball. Delaware might want to then run Mosley off some screens so he can come get the ball up at the top. That forced Pinkard to almost over-dribble the ball, but I thought he did a nice job there of at least settling it, and then the foul occurred.
Holden back in the game, as is Marvin King-Davis. New shot clock for Delaware. Holden guarded by Chile. Inside out dribble goes nowhere with it. Corbett, NBA range, three, knocks it through. He had four in the first half against James Madison and hits on his first try tonight from long range.
Corbett is clearly a rhythm shooter. That time he was allowed to curl in, working left to right to get his shoulder square. He does a great job of setting his feet and is always balanced when he shoots other than when he's off the dribble.
32 threes on the season in Chavarsky Corbett's rookie campaign. He has Delaware within seven. And Marvin King Davis comes over from the help side to block the shot of Chile on the other end.
That's really smart defense. Holden forced the ball down towards the baseline, sending Chile there. Now here comes the shot blocker rotating from the weak side in a perfect position and great timing to block the shot.
10th block on the season for King Davis, tied with Barnett Harris for third most now on the team. 14 to shoot for Chile off the inbound. It's Johnson beyond the arc with 10 to shoot. 8:19 left in the first half. Chile calling out orders. Top of the key. Four to shoot for Chile. He drives. Pinkard's there on defense. Ball's loose out of bounds with 1 second on the shot clock. It goes back to Delaware.
Pinkard continues to do excellent work at the defensive end. He's had a nice help. He had a good double team there. He was great in influencing the ball to be dribbled out. Plus, he's got three rebounds. He's very active defensively.
Here's Pinker now on offense. Dribbles in. Sets himself up for a two. Extended foul line right. And Devon Pinkard on cue. Does it on the offensive side.
For a young man that used to just be a spot-up shooter, he's getting much better in that mid-range and off the bounce. I really like the expansion of his game.
Shooting now closer to 30% from two-point range. It was in single digits for the beginning of this sophomore year for Pinkert. Kyle Charleston working around the perimeter. Inside it goes to Beru. Left block, King Davis. In defense, but Beru too strong and gets it through off the window. Leads 22-15 Cougars.
I thought Marvin King Davis did a good job of challenging Beru, not allowing him into the middle, but then the bump created the space.
Corner three, Chavarsky Corbett strong from the left side after the pass by Holden found an open freshman Corbett. Here's Chile feeding the big man again. Turns and faces this time. That's good for Ajay Beru with a few words for the Delaware bench after he made that one. 9-point lead for the Cougars.
I'm not sure Beru wants to do that, especially when you're on the road. Just play the game. Don't be looking at the bench.
Corbett, corner left side, this time decides to dribble with it and gets fouled by the Cougars. That's the seventh on Charleston. So an 82% free throw shooter will have a 1-on-1 when we come back here on 94.7 WDSD. Charleston up 24-15, 6:51 left in the first. We are the champions.
Throw your hands up, welcome to the other land of dreamers, brothers, sisters, others. Yeah, we on fire like that.
You can now watch all Hens All Access content on any of your devices. Whether you're at the store on your phone or on the couch with your iPad or laptop, Hens All Access live and on-demand content is just a touch away. Not only will live games be available on your mobile devices, they'll also be available in high definition. Best of all, you don't even need an app. Just click over to BlueHens.com on your device and take the Hens anywhere you go.
See you all then. Thank you. Back here at the Bob Carpenter Center, the College of Charleston Cougars up 24-15 over Delaware. That's our score. No scores around the CAA quite yet, but our Glasgow Medical 8 units scoreboard update tells us that UNCW will be at Drexel starting at 4 o'clock. William Mary will be at James Madison at 4 o'clock. At 7, Elon heads up to Boston. And at 8 o'clock, Towson and Hofstra up in New York. And a big score in the top 25, Notre Dame, after beating Duke just the other day, falls to Pittsburgh 76-72. Former head coach here at Delaware, Mike Bray, with the Fighting Irish. And early on in the first half, Kansas up over Kansas State 24-10. Villanova, 7th-ranked team in the country, down against DePaul. That one early in the first as well, 15-11. The score there. Jarski Corbett at the free throw line. He shoots a 1-on-1. Right now, when you look in the box score for our game, College of Charleston, just too many points in the paint.
They've been able to enter the lane from the top way too often. Delaware's got to do a better job of keeping the ball on the side. And then the big men have been fairly successful. We've noticed that Delaware tends not to double-team those, but let's look for a change-up, maybe play some zone in there, or at least run another defender at the post player to make him pass the ball out.
Corbett makes the first free throw. Knocks in the second as well. New shoes for Jabarski Corbett. The bright yellow Nikes. I asked him what that's all about. The yellow LeBrons, he said. He said he wore LeBron's shoes when he was in high school at Tampa Catholic. And they're certainly working. He's got 5 points today and 4 3-pointers against the Dukes.
You got that story talking to Corbett. You must be a shoe guy.
I like the kicks here. A lot of guys with different sneaks here at Delaware as this game continues. Barry's three will be waved off as there's a foul away from the ball as Gilmore. That's the second time that Kyle Charleston has been called for a foul away from the ball in the last couple of possessions. His first in the team's 8.
Boy, Delaware lucky there, too, because Kenyon Berry rose right up in the shot and just drilled that three. Some off the ball. I think the officials are trying to control it a little bit. We saw a lot of contact early on in the game that they did not call.
Here's Corbett, right side, working towards the left, centers it up. Nearly a reach and foul by Gilmore. Pinkard jumps over the diving Gilmore as the ball came loose. Shot nearly blocked. Pinkard was able to pass out to Hayes. Now a foul line jumper by King Davis. Too strong. Not a good possession that time as Delaware's all out of sorts. It goes back to College of Charleston.
You're right. Pinkard did not realize that the defender had recovered, and that's usually a great opportunity to block the shot.
Here's Barry off the curl. Catch and shoot off the mark from two-point range. Tracking down the rebound is Kasman Hayes, a good defender, good rebounder out of that guard position. Here's Holden with his team down by 7. Top key, Corbett squares, fires, hits. Jabarski Corbett, 6 3-pointer in 2 games, and the Hens back within 4.
And that's that curl left to right. The left-handed shooter, Corbett, loves that maneuver, but he does a great job of squaring himself up and always in perfect balance as he releases.
Here's Barry in the corner, guarded by the freshman Corbett. The long arms of number 0, giving Barry some problems. He passes out, 15 to shoot. Johnson, who had 6 points early, gets it to Barry. Barry bounce pass inside of Gilmore. Gilmore fouled on the reach, just the third foul on Delaware, but it'll send Donovan Gilmore, a good free throw shooter, to shoot 2.
Good activity off the ball there by Charleston. They do a nice job of screening and cutting. Good movement patterns away from it. Makes very difficult to then provide a lot of help because you've always got to locate your man.
First foul on Devon Pinkard. Gilmore at the line shooting 2. He had 12 points against Delaware, did Gilmore. But since January 10th, just 13 points combined in 5 games, scoreless in 3 of those contests. So he's been struggling. They try to mix it up, getting Terrence O'Donohue in the starting lineup. O'Donohue picks up 2 quick fouls, and Gilmore back in, knocking in the first free throw.
Well, at 6'7", 205, Gilmore takes a lot of contact. And it's a very physical game in the CAA, and I think sometimes for freshmen who are playing inside, that can kind of create a toll on the body, and maybe that's some of the reason his minutes have declined.
Here's Corbett after the miss from Gilmore. Can't make that one, but an offense rebound by Jeffers, and a jump ball goes to College of Charleston. Does the arrow. A nice job by Jeffers, but an excellent follow-up by the College of Charleston to get a hand in there and force the tie.
Well, they double-teamed Moe as soon as he got it. Unfortunately, Moe had the ball down just a little too low. If he could have gotten it up around his chin and been able to pivot away, that might have helped him not get the jump ball. But I always feel possession is worth a point. They changed the shot, the possession arrow there. So a nice job on the weak side by Moe Jeffers.
Something was on the floor. So the officiating crew blows the whistle, and that gives Delaware to set up a chance to set up some full court man-to-man pressure as they get into Chile. Trying to trap, excuse me. Ours Corbett, ball coming our way. Brew has to jump for it. Saves it inbounds. And Kyle to Charleston with Johnson on the wing. And now Chile will run the offense center circle. 22 seconds on the shot clock. Cougars up by five. It's 25-20. They've led by as many as 10. Here's Johnson setting himself up for a two, and that one down from about 17 feet on the right side.
Johnson's got a quick release for a freshman. Corbett did a nice job of challenging the shot. He was able to get it out over the outstretched arms. A very fine athlete, Cameron Johnson.
Here's Corbett, right wing, inside to Jeffers is how the game started. Jeffers against Brew, goes baseline, flips it up, reverse. It's through, but they said he stepped on the baseline, and a turnover despite the aggressive move by Mo Jeffers.
He did a great job of facing up Beru. Beru not as quick as Mo Jeffers. A little head fake to the middle, then goes on the baseline. Just stepped out probably by an inch, but did a nice job with a Mikan move, that reverse layup using the rim as a shot block protector. Good offense by Mo Jeffers. And again, staying out of foul troubles enabled him to play more minutes here.
Chile nearly travels as he lost his footing, but kept his dribble alive and gets it back to Barry. They have a catch with it beyond the arc. He checks the shot clock. It's at 18. Johnson having a good game so far. Gets in the paint. Stripped away. Quick hands by Hayes. It ends with the grip of Jeffers ahead to hold it. Delaware down by seven. Jeffers back to hold it. Holden driving left side. Brings it back out.
Well, that was a great job there of packing the lane by the University of Delaware. Especially Mo Jeffers in perfect position to help out and then got the loose ball.
Holden to Anderson. Beru guarding Holden, and Holden allows Charleston to be able to switch as he goes to Anderson. Now back to Holden, kick out. Hayes open for a three-point shot. Wing this time, it's good from Casmin Hayes, who's been shooting lights out from long range, 50% over the last three games, and he gets Delaware within four.
Great offense. They ran Kyle Anderson off two screens that drew the help on the weak side, quickly rotated to Holden, who drove the lane and then kicked out to Casmin Hayes. Reversal of the ball, changing the floor, creating the help to move. A great job. And one of the best offensive possessions of the year.
Here's Bailey with a three right back. They left the freshman alone, and the 34% three-point shooter made his 18th of the year. Lead back up to seven for the Cougars. Strong answer.
Pretty confident shot there. He was not reading his own stat sheet on that.
Here's Jeffords spinning inside off the mark, trying to follow his own miss. Cannot, as Johnson tracks it down near the right sideline. It's Johnson ahead. Bailey again, the freshman, back-to-back threes, and the lead is 10 again.
Well, Delaware a little frustrated here, but what you've got to do, we talked about transition defense. You've got to get out and acquire those shooters early on, especially someone that looks like they're going to rise up into the shot again, and you've got to make them put the ball on the floor.
Here's Holden with the take. Kick out Hayes. Hayes a triple. Four three-pointers in a row. Two from the Hens, two from the College of Charleston.
And Coach Grant is chastising his defense there for helping off the corner. He does not want to have that happen. He wants Holden to have to beat the big guys in the lane.
It's been Bailey and Hayes. Bailey again. Can he do it for the third time in a row? Missing on the heat check. It's Anderson with a rebound. Up the floor he goes. His team down by seven. Getting into the paint and drawing some contact. That's a foul against Charleston. Their ninth. And Kyle Anderson will shoot the 1-on-1 when we get back. A timeout taken as things are heating up from beyond the arc. The Cougars up 33-26 over the Hens.
Delaware Athletics sponsors 21 teams comprised of over 600 student-athletes and will award nearly 230 scholarships costing $9.5 million this year. Blue Hen fans across the nation contribute to the University of Delaware Athletic Fund each year. Your contributions provide scholarships, equipment, and academic support so UD student-athletes can compete in the sport they love and receive a college education.
Rush hour or relax hour? It's your choice. Dark. Moving forward.
We have the pieces. Now it's time to bring them together. Every dribble and every rep turns into every point and every win. It's winning time again. Experience it.
Ken Ethereal, KJT. KJT is signed by head coach Monte Ross. You won a great prize. You want you to stand up.
Here at the Bob Carpenter Center, I'm Scott Klatskin alongside Bill Harmon. 33-26 is the count. Charleston on top by 7. Three-point shots have been flying on both sides. Delaware is 4 of 13 from two-point range, 5 of 11 from three-point range, as Kasman Hayes has made 2, Corbett has made 2, and one off the hands of the free-throw shooter, Kyle Anderson. He's got a 1-1.
Well, Delaware has done a nice job of running their offense. They've been sharing the ball. They've been reversing the floor with the pass and with the dribble, getting their three-point shooters, other than a couple early on by Kyle Anderson, uncontested looks at the basket.
Anderson makes the first free throw, 79% free throw shooter on the season. Just a possession ago, Kasman Hayes made his second three-pointer of the game. And he's been shooting well from beyond the arc. He was 7 of 14 coming in. Now trap. Barry gets it to Bailey. Bailey has been hot, challenging Jeffers, too strong, and a miss. Delaware gets the rebound after Anderson goes 1 of 2 from the free throw line. Anderson to Holden. Jab step in the corner. Wraps it around to Jeffers, and too much, as that's a turnover.
Now Holden was trying to do the right thing, delivering kind of a slip pass to Mo Jeffers, who was on his back trailing from the left side. But unfortunately, he wrapped it around so closely, Jeffers had no opportunity to catch it. A turnover, and that's on Holden.
Holden has 5 assists, already above his game average in the first half. Bailey wide open from 3, this time missing. He made his first 2, has missed his last 2, and Pierre knocks it out of bounds.
Bailey, whose father played at the Naval Academy, University of Pittsburgh, and his mother was a volleyball player at Pitt, so he's got some great genetic genes in him in terms of basketball and athleticism, but now he's kind of rolling back down to his statistical average.
Under a minute left to go. Delaware down 33-27. Holden, a lot of dribbling. Kick outside to Hayes. He's had the hot hand. Can't stay hot. Front rim miss. And Johnson wants to go for Charleston. Timeout taken by Earl Grant to draw something up with 48.3 seconds on the first half clock and a 6-point lead.
Hayes, who at times has a little bit of a flat release, was contested there by Canyon Berry, and that's the problem. When you have to shoot over a taller player, you've got to be able to adjust, and when you're shooting a challenge shot, there's almost no opportunity to change that. So mechanically, if Kasman can get a little bit wider open shot, or when he has Berry attacking him, shot fake and either respace to the three if you need to take the three, or attack the lane, which we've seen him do. I'd like to see at times Hayes get to the basket a little bit more often because he's so successful in there.
Yeah, we saw him do that a lot in the beginning portions of this season. Hayes double figures in 15 of 20 games this season. He had double figures in the first 7 before Kyle Anderson came back. 5 of the last 6 Hayes has met double figures. He's got 6 today. Corbett has 8, 6 for Anderson to lead the Hens. They trail by 6. And Earl Grant, first-year head coach, an assistant at Clemson, Wichita State, and Winthrop before coming to the college in September. Just drew something up. Cheely has it. Brings it over to the right side. Barry, a 3 from the corner. That one's strong, and Jeffers a rebound.
Delaware switched to zone there. A great job by the staff out of a timeout. They have not shown zone in a couple of games. They've shown a little bit of pressure out of timeouts, but here's zone, and that affected the shot.
About a 5-second difference between the game clock and the shot clock. Shot clock at 19 now. Holden stands deep right side, trying to take what could be the final shot, or at least make it difficult for Charleston to get one off. 9 seconds now. Holden deep right side. Screen comes from Jeffers. Holden dribbling to his left side. Gets in deep. Draws the foul against Glenn Pierre, his second, and Holden going to the free throw line for the first time today.
Holden did a nice job there of recognizing that they were playing no help off the corner. So once he turned himself and got into the defense, he was going to face a rotating shot blocker from the inside, but no help from the outside. Nice job by Holden there drawing the foul.
Holden, very good free throw shooter. First trip today. Shoots 74% on the season. Makes the first. Holden, 5 assists, 2 turnovers over the last 6 games coming in. 37 assists for Holden and just 10 turnovers since that 10-turnover game against UNCW. He's really done a nice job of taking care of the rock for the Hens.
And he's very good in the in-game situations, typically because of good decision-making, but also just that, being able to make fouls. Barnett Harris in the game, going to see some more continued 1-2-1-1 pressure.
Holden makes them both. Full court presser with 8 seconds left. Chile still in the backcourt. Hesitates, dribble. Holden lets him pass. And he stepped on the sideline. So with 4.1 remaining, Delaware going to have a chance to score again before heading into the locker room. Great job by Barnett Harris on the full court pressure.
Absolutely. And Delaware did have a foul to give there, so they could have fouled. A little fortunate there that he stepped out of bounds. But it's another thing I see so often. Why are dribblers trying to dribble through and around a double team instead of pulling the ball back and throwing it over the top?
4.1 seconds on the inbound. Holden to Anderson at the buzzer. Kyle Anderson just missing. That was on the line. But the Hens trail by 4 at the break against the College of Charleston. A nice design to try to beat the clock, and I thought that one was through. Looked good off the hands of Kyle Anderson, but then again, what doesn't look good off the hands of Kyle
Anderson? I agree with
Anderson.
You. Corey Holden did a great job of not only knowing that he had Anderson there, but he delivered the ball directly in Kyle Anderson's shooting pocket so he could go right up into it. A very nice challenge there, the shot by Cameron Johnson.
We'll take a timeout. We come back. Ronnie Vickers is back at the WDSG studios. It's Energized Delaware at the half, presented by the International Brotherhood of Electrical Workers, Local 313, and its local contractors. Back in a moment. The score at the half, College of Charleston 33, Delaware 29.
Delaware Athletics sponsors 21 teams comprised of over 600 student-athletes and will award nearly 230 scholarships costing $9.5 million this year. Blue Hen fans across the nation contribute to the University of Delaware Athletic Fund each year. Your contributions provide scholarships, equipment, and academic support so UD student-athletes can compete in the sport they love and receive a college education.
We have the pieces. Now it's time to bring them together. Every dribble and every rep turns into every point and every win. It's winning time again. Experience it.
Cheer more in Baltimore as the road to the Final Four kicks off with the Colonial Athletic Association Men's Basketball Championship, March 6th through 9th at the Royal Farms Arena. A new money-saving fan package includes a room at your choice of hotels, 2 harbor passes, 2 admissions to the Power Play It Live Fan Fest, and an option to purchase discounted tickets for the championship. Come for the tourney and stay for the fun. Score your fan package today at Baltimore.org.
Hold on to me as we go. Just know you're not alone. 'Cause I'm gonna make this place yours.
It really is a Blue Hens state of mind, and it's all about heading back to Baltimore to defend our crown. It's called March Madness for a reason. Your Blue Hens squad returns to Royal Farms Arena for the CAA Men's Basketball Championship, March 6th through March 9th. So much to see, so much to do. For the absolute best seats available to Blue Hen fans, visit BlueHens.com for more information.
We are the champions, setting it off again. Oh, we on fire, we on fire. Running our own campaign, doing the whole shebang. Oh, we on fire, we on fire. Get up, stand up, throw your hands up. Welcome to the other land of dreamers, brothers, sisters, others. Yeah, we all fight like that.
Hey fans, 12 and younger, do you want to be a future Blue Hen? Join the Future Hens Club presented by St. Francis Healthcare for invites to exclusive events and free admission to select UD games.
Meet coaches and players like us.
Get your official Future Hens t-shirt and more surprises.
To join, log on bluehens.com with a parent, click on Fan Zone, then Kids Club. Click Register Here, fill out your information, and click Submit.
Join today!
Rush hour or relax hour? It's your choice. Dark. Moving forward.
You can now watch all Hens All Access content on any of your devices. Whether you're at the store on your phone or on the couch with your iPad or laptop, Hens All Access live and on-demand content is just a touch away. Not only will live games be available on your mobile devices, they'll also be available in high definition. Best of all, you don't even need an app. Just click over to BlueHens.com on your device and take the Hens anywhere you go.
Cheer more in Baltimore as the road to the Final Four kicks off with the Colonial Athletic Association Men's Basketball Championship, March 6th through 9th at the Royal Farms Arena. A new money-saving fan package includes a room at your choice of hotels, two harbor passes, two admissions to the Power Play at Live Fan Fest, and an option to purchase discounted tickets for the championship. Come for the tourney and stay for the fun. Score your fan package today at Baltimore.org.
Hello, Delaware fans. This is Coach Brock at beautiful Lums Pond State Park, just minutes from Delaware Stadium. I'm inviting you to come to the park, enjoy their year-round camping, boat rentals, equestrian center, and so much more. While you're here, experience the Go Ape Treetop Adventure. Go Ape is an outdoor experience where you can live life adventurously and experience the park from 50 feet up in the trees, hanging by a wire. To learn more about Go Ape or to book your visit to the course, visit www.goape.com. Go Hens!
Delaware Athletics sponsors 21 teams comprised of over 600 student-athletes and will award nearly 230 scholarships costing $9.5 million this year. Blue Hen fans across the nation contribute to the University of Delaware Athletic Fund each year. Your contributions provide scholarships, equipment, and academic support so UD student-athletes can compete in the sport they love and receive a college education.
We are the champions, setting it off again. Oh, we on fire, we on fire. Running our own campaign, doing the whole shebang. Oh, we on fire, we on fire. Get up, stand up, throw your hands up. Welcome to the other land of dreamers, brothers, sisters, others. Yeah, we all fight like that.
We have the pieces. Now it's time to bring them together. Every dribble and every rep turns into every point and every win. It's winning time again. Experience it.
Delaware Athletics sponsors 21 teams comprised of over 600 student-athletes and will award nearly 230 scholarships costing $9.5 million this year. Blue Hen fans across the nation contribute to the University of Delaware Athletic Fund each year. Your contributions provide scholarships, equipment, and academic support so UD student-athletes can compete in the sport they love and receive a college education.
We have the pieces. Now it's time to bring them together. Every dribble and every rep turns into every point and every win. It's winning time again. Experience it.
Cheer more in Baltimore as the road to the Final Four kicks off with the Colonial Athletic Association Men's Basketball Championship, March 6th through 9th at the Royal Farms Arena. A new money-saving fan package includes a room at your choice of hotels, two harbor passes, two admissions to the Power Play at Live Fan Fest, and an option to purchase discounted tickets for the championship. Come for the tourney and stay for the fun. Score your fan package today at Baltimore.org.
Hold on to me as we go. Just know you're not alone. 'Cause I'm gonna make this place yours.
really is a Blue Hens state of mind, and it's all about heading back to Baltimore to defend our crown. It's called March Madness for a reason. Your Blue Hens squad returns to Royal Farms Arena for the CAA Men's Basketball Championship, March 6th through March 9th. So much to see, so much to do. For the absolute best seats available to Blue Hen fans, visit BlueHens.com for more information.
We are the champions, setting it off again. Oh, we on fire, we on fire. Running our own campaign, doing the whole shebang. Oh, we on fire, we on fire. Get up, stand up, throw your hands up. Welcome to the other land of dreamers, brothers, sisters, others. Yeah, we all fight like that.
Hey fans, 12 and younger, do you want to be a future Blue Hen? Join the Future Hens Club presented by St. Francis Healthcare for invites to exclusive events and free admission to select UD games.
Meet coaches and players like us.
Get your official Future Hens t-shirt and more surprises.
To join, log on BlueHens.com with a parent, click on Fan Zone, then Kids Club. Click Register Here, fill out your information, and click Submit.
Join today!
Rush hour or relax hour? It's your choice. Dark. Moving forward.
You can now watch all Hens All Access content on any of your devices. Whether you're at the store on your phone or on the couch with your iPad or laptop, Hens All Access live and on-demand content is just a touch away. Not only will live games be available on your mobile devices, they'll also be available in high definition. Best of all, you don't even need an app. Just click over to BlueHens.com on your device and take the Hens anywhere you go.
Cheer more in Baltimore as the road to the Final Four kicks off with the Colonial Athletic Association Men's Basketball Championship, March 6th through 9th at the Royal Farms Arena. A new money-saving fan package includes a room at your choice of hotels, two harbor passes, two admissions to the Power Play It Live Fan Fest, and an option to purchase discounted tickets for the championship. Come for the tourney and stay for the fun. Score your fan package today at Baltimore.org.
Hello, Delaware fans. This is Coach Brock at beautiful Lums Pond State Park, just minutes from Delaware Stadium. I'm inviting you to come to the park, enjoy their year-round camping, boat rentals, equestrian center, and so much more. While you're here, experience the Go Ape Treetop Adventure. Go Ape is an outdoor experience where you can live life adventurously and experience the park from 50 feet up in the trees, hanging by a wire. To learn more about Go Ape or to book your visit to the course, visit www.goape.com. Go Hens!
Delaware Athletics sponsors 21 teams comprised of over 600 student-athletes and will award nearly 230 scholarships costing $9.5 million this year. Blue Hen fans across the nation contribute to the University of Delaware Athletic Fund each year. Your contributions provide scholarships, equipment, and academic support so UD student-athletes can compete in the sport they love and receive a college education.
We are the champions, setting it off again. Oh, we on fire, we on fire. Running our own campaign, doing the whole shebang. Oh, we on fire, we on fire. Get up, stand up, throw your hands up. Welcome to the other land of dreamers, brothers, sisters, others. Yeah, we all fight like that.
We have the pieces. Now it's time to bring them together. Every dribble and every rep turns into every point and every win. It's winning time again. Experience it.
Delaware Athletics sponsors 21 teams comprised of over 600 student-athletes and will award nearly 230 scholarships costing $9.5 million this year. Blue Hen fans across the nation contribute to the University of Delaware Athletic Fund each year. Your contributions provide scholarships, equipment, and academic support so UD student-athletes can compete in the sport they love and receive a college education.
Rebounds for Cameron Johnson from that guard position. Joe Chile, two assists, but three turnovers. Both teams taking care of the basketball for the most part. Six turnovers each. Kyle Charleston, though, shooting 56% from the field. They're 15 of 27. Two of eight from long range. The only player to make any threes, Evan Bailey, and just one of three from the free throw line. Delaware will get the basketball first to start the second half. They'll be shooting in front of their bench, going right to left, wearing the home whites. Kyle Charleston and the road maroon and gold uniforms. Starters on the floor for the Hens as Corey Holden brings it up.
A nice set play here, I think we'll see. And let's look for Delaware to go back inside, doing a little high-low and possibly some ball screens off the midline.
Hayes has it on top, guarded by Barry to Anderson on the wing. Inside to Jeffers is how the game got started in the first half. Jeffers working on Baru, too strong with the right hand off the window.
A good look, though. They ran a nice set to get Mo Jeffers the ball exactly where he wanted. Left shoulder turn, right-hand jump hook against Baru, just missed.
And Jeffers has looked good against Baru in this contest. Here's Baru on the other side. It's Barry guarded by Anderson. Leans in off the window. That's a fundamental shot for Canyon. Barry gets it to go, and the Hens trail by six.
A very smart player Barry is. Had Anderson just rubbed off the Baru screen and used the backboard.
Corner, it's Hayes trying to get into King Davis. King Davis instructing to reverse court. They go to the left side. It's Holden now. Now reposting is Marvin King Davis, and a foul away from the ball as Anderson was held up. That's four fouls away from the ball in this game for Kyle Charleston in the first of the second half.
Kyle Anderson reminds me of John Stockton, the terrific point guard from Utah. He is willing to set big-time screens inside and get run over by a bigger man coming from the weak side. That was a screen for Marvin King Davis, who was wide open, but Kyle Anderson really getting hit, but sacrificing his body for his teammates.
And now they're going to look at the monitor. I think that's a great comparison. Anderson, although he has such a smooth stroke from the outside, not afraid to get tangled up and play aggressive basketball on the inside as well. We're a minute into the second half of action, and the officials taking a look at the monitor just to make sure that a flagrant does not need to be called. You're seeing this more and more in the game of college basketball. You want to get the call right. You want to make sure that if there needs to be a penalty beyond just a regular foul, that it is called. There was a game, though, and I can't remember which team was taking part, but there was an eight-minute delay the other day. You like the idea of getting it right. Your thoughts on the process, though, Bill?
Maybe I'm so old school. If in a perfect world, I would say, hey, let the officials do it real time.
They didn't have TV monitors back when you were.
You're right, and I'm still trying to figure out how radio works.
I'm
you're absolutely right. But you're right in one hand, but I think there's got to be a time limit. They've got to make this call more quickly. It disrupts the game. It already has a lot of media timeouts, as we know. Each team has five timeouts, so there's a lot of disruption to the flow of the game, which I think as a player, other than that potential rest moment, but here we've just entered the second half, only 59 seconds. I think the game's got to flow better. I think that would create better play by teams, but I do agree with you in that on some of these fouls, you've got to get the call right. But they've got three officials. You ought to be able to cover a half-court game with three officials, and you've got to see that. And I think it goes back to a point I've made with you time and time again. The game is called differently out on the perimeter than it is in the post, and I think at times you've almost had to spend a lot of time in the post to understand the subtleties in there, maybe to get some of those calls in real time more accurately.
Kyle Charleston does lead by six as the official aiding crew still looking at the monitors. It's going to be tough to, I think, find a good angle because it was away from the ball. So the great staff that Jimmy Smith has here filming the game for Hens All Access might not have a great angle of Anderson and O'Donohue. But not to be missed, whether it's a flagrant or not, O'Donohue picks up his third foul 59 seconds into the second half. Here's a guy that's been playing good basketball as of late, put into the starting lineup by Earl Grant and just has not been able to find his way to stay on the floor. Only 5 minutes in the first half, now playing in his sixth minute, picks up his third, and he might have to sit again as it looks like Gilmore will check in after the officials are done looking at the monitor, which they are still doing.
This was a little for big screen away. And I think a lot of players in college, O'Donohue only a sophomore, they don't know how to get over a screen. We say so often that less capable defenders are always screened. So you've got to anticipate that. You've got to start to cheat over the screen or sink under, which would then allow the player, in this case Marvin King Davis, to step back for a mid-range shot. So you've got to become, as a good defender, almost unpickable. But what I love was the sacrifice of the body by Kyle Anderson, continuing to do so many small things that you really have to watch him closely to appreciate how much he adds to the game. We all know he's a wonderful outside shooter, plays hard, but he does. He's first to the floor. He gets an offensive rebound every now and then at 6'3". He runs the court in transition. I'm talking about offense to defense to get back to challenge a shot. He sets the screens. He makes the extra pass. This is a young man that if he goes into coaching, he's going to be a superb coach.
I'm with you. And if you come to a game at the Bob Carpenter Center, take a couple possessions and just keep an eye on Anderson. Whether he has the ball or not, just watch him move. And there's a guy that you want to teach the youth how to play the game of basketball. It's impressive. After all that, nothing extra. Just a foul on O'Donohue. And we're ready to inbound. Holding going to throw it in. Jeffers with it near the three-point line on the right side, trying to get it back to the point guard, Holden. Has to go to King Davis. Now King Davis trying to get to Holden. Holden working hard to get the basketball. Finally does so. With 27 to shoot. Gets to Anderson on the wing. Dumps it into King Davis. Working on the smaller Johnson, and Johnson has to hold him up to prevent any interior play. That's the second foul on College of Charleston here in the second half.
Another smart play by Kyle Anderson. He realized that he had the shorter Johnson, a guard, covering Marvin King Davis at the low block, playing behind. Anderson delivers the ball right away, creates the foul.
Second foul on Cameron Johnson. Now Jeffers again. Same spot, gets the inbound. This time able to hand it off to Holden, who resets. Anderson off the curl, inside to King Davis. Turns, mid-right block, short that time. And skying for the rebound is Donovan Gilmore, who just checked it.
A good look by Marvin King Davis. He loves that shot. Mo Jeffers just mistimed the jump, or he would have had the offensive rebound. Well positioned, though.
Canyon Berry to Johnson at the foul line. Step back to Gilmore. Gilmore left alone at the wing right side. It's Cheely now. Cheely. Cross-court pass to Barrett. Anderson defends. One dribble. Pass to Chile. He squares, fires around, and out rebound by Marvin King Davis, the team's leader in rebounds per game. Now it's Holden. Dribbling left to right. Screen comes from King Davis. Holden picks up his dribble. Over to Anderson. Anderson step back, but now interior passing inside to Jeffers. Jeffers working hard on Baru. Gets contact. Finishes strong. Big Mo draws the foul on Ajay Baru and will go to the free throw line.
And this play starts by the simple fact that Kyle Anderson delivers the ball to Mo Jeffers in a place where he wants it, right at the top of the block on the left side. Mo then goes into the middle with his right hand, his left shoulder for jump hook. Baru challenges him, but too much topside, and then a great seal maneuver by Mo Jeffers. I just love that footwork, but it all starts with a fine entry pass by Kyle Anderson.
And Jeffers makes the free throw. He shoots the same percentage from the field as he does from the free throw line, but knocked it through there. And Delaware was in three. It's 35-32. Here's Baru challenging Jeffers, and a foul on the floor as Jeffers just a step too late to get over to defend the big man.
And I think Mo, when he realizes that Baru has a little bit of an edge on him along the baseline, let him go because he's going so far under that he's got no opportunity to score, and Mo is right there on his hip. I think he'd have been better off just let him go there and then come out the weak side and contest his shot.
Second foul on Jeffers. First on Delaware this half. Cheely with it. Left side. Back door. Had buried it. Passed it to him, though. Instead, Johnson on top. Barry collects on the right wing instead. Dribbles between the circles now. Cheely lobs it inside to Gilmore. Gilmore catches it. Shot blocked by Jeffers. Now it's on the floor. Ball is loose. King Davis drives. Baru from his back. Finds his teammate, but just 13 seconds on the shot clock. Cheely wide open, drives the lane. Inside shot swatted by King Davis, poked away. Here's Hayes ahead of the pack, has King Davis with him. Takes it up himself instead, lays it up, and the Hens are down just one.
And that's just the play, so perfectly described by you, Scott, that Coach Cheeks was talking about. Impose will against College of Charleston. Attack the basket. Casman Hayes doing just that.
Here's Cheely. Hens within a point, 35-34. On top, Cheely right side, 17 to shoot. Hens picking up the defensive intensity. Here's Barry on the wing, driving on Anderson. Floats it strong off the window. Back tap and an offensive board for Cheely. Quickly to Johnson. Johnson baseline left, challenging Jeffers. Gets Jeffers off his feet and contact with the body gives Jeffers his third.
What I've loved about Delaware here in this game, they've been much more aggressive defensively. Even though some technical things have gone wrong, they've blocked out well. They've got their hands on some deflections. They have blocked shots. They've contested shots much better. That time, Mo has a smaller player, Mo Jeffers, smaller player driving, stay rooted to the ground and then wait to go up. That way the body contact won't create the foul.
Johnson makes the first free throw, 71% free throw shooter at 8 points in his debut against Delaware. 16-38, second half here, and Johnson, second free throw good as well, and lead back up to three for the College of Charleston. Cougars in this game have led by 10 points. Delaware scored the first bucket. That was their only lead of the game. Hold it on top, over to Hayes. Hayes on the wing. Jab step, driving, aggressive move by Hayes. Flips it up with a reverse. Aspen Hayes again.
He must have heard us in the first half talking about driving the ball. He's so good and has great body control. He's got a quickness matchup advantage with Kenyon Berry right now playing him.
Hayes again in double figures for the 16th time this season. Here's Berry, loses his footing. That's a traveling violation. The turnover gives it back to Delaware with a chance to take the lead.
I think Coach Ross and his staff did a really good job there of letting Mo Jeffers play on after that third foul. He's going to come out here, but I like the fact they stayed with him. Otherwise, typically they bring him right out. I think Mo just has to play more consistent minutes to continue to improve. But I watched him down here, his intensity. He's so mentally involved in this game. This is the best I've seen him play in a while.
I got to agree with that, as Jeffers will get a blow. Carter comes in. King Davis with the basketball. Over to Hayes, who has had the hot hand in the corner. Holding off the curl. He gets it on the wing. Looking for Anderson. Such a quick release for Anderson. Hand in the face. And over Chile. The senior sinks it. Delaware back on top.
Chile is shaking his head because he thought he had a great contest. But anytime you let Kyle Anderson come off a pin down screen and square himself up and he rises up, the ball's already gone because of his quick release. That was a great set there run by Coach Ross.
Ends up by two, now defending. King Davis guarding Baru. Whistle before the shot on the floor. That'll send us to a timeout with Delaware taking a second half lead. Back in a moment on 94.7 WDSC with UD up 39-37.
Hey fans, 12 and younger. Do you want to be a future Blue Hen? Join the Future Hens Club presented by St. Francis Healthcare for invites to exclusive events and free admission to select UD games.
Meet coaches and players like us.
Get your official Future Hens t-shirt and more surprises.
To join, log on bluehens.com with a parent, click on Fan Zone, then Kids Club. Click Register Here, fill out your information, and click Submit.
Join today!
We have the pieces. Now it's time to bring them together. Every dribble and every rep turns into every point and every win. It's winning time again. Experience it.
Welcome back to WDSD. I'm Scott Klatskin alongside Bill Harmon. I want to remind our listeners to head over to Capriati's Sandwich Shop. You need some tailgating trays for that big game tomorrow. Patriots, Seahawks, former UD football player Marcus Burley on the Legion of Boom. Well, if you need something to eat, go over to Capriati's Sandwich Shop at the Newark Shopping Center or at 4422 Kirkwood Highway to pick up trays for tailgating for your Super Bowl party. Head to Capriati's.com. Put your order in for some delicious sandwiches from Capriati's in the Newark Shopping Center and on Kirkwood Highway. Delaware leads 39-37, and the intensity up a notch for these Hens to start the second half, Bill.
Delaware seems much more alert at both ends. They've been getting on the floor for loose balls. Mo Jeffers started out with a great low post move and then activity on the defensive end. Delaware continues, I think, to execute their offense about as well as I've seen in several weeks.
As they come back from timeout, the officials talking to the scorer's table, waiting for College Charleston get the basketball, perhaps looking at the shot clock. It's at 24, 15-15 on the clock. O'Donohue back in, playing with three fouls. although I haven't seen much difference in the productivity from this team, whether Gilmore or O'Donohue is on the floor.
They seem to be very similar players to me, and he's just basically, Coach Grant has 10 fouls to give there.
And they do reset the shot clock. It was at 24, now at 35. And the College of Charleston will inbound left side to Beru. Cheely, the inbounder, gets it off the handoff. Brings it back beyond the arc. Holden defends well. He passes to Johnson. Johnson a couple dribbles. Cheely running the offense, 25 to shoot now as Hayes defends on Johnson on a big first half for these guys. Evan Bailey off the bench, 2 3-pointers in the first half, passes out. It's Johnson left side. Carter comes out to help. Now on top to Bailey. Bailey one dribble and a pass to Cheely. O'Donohue working hard down low, doesn't get the pass. Instead, Cheely pulls the trigger on a three and a rebound by Kasman Hayes. O'Donohue with number 4. He just can't stay on the floor tonight.
Well, that shot was out of range. And then Delaware did a good job of immediately sealing off on the backside. And O'Donohue just completely out of position. It's a young mistake, just working over the back. If you don't have good position, sprint back on defense. And that again, gets Delaware closer to the 1-1.
And great points that you make, but also Kasman Hayes, really a very good defender, or good rebounder for this team. Able to snatch it. Inside King Davis, working hard on the inside. Ball fake, over 2! And MKD gives Delaware a 4-point lead.
For the first time all game, Marvin King Davis was fronted. An immediate read by Kyle Anderson, who realized there was no help. Marvin did a nice job with poise and a shot fake to center himself.
Here's Johnson, loses it, out of bounds. Delaware basketball, another turnover for the College of Charleston, their 8th. And Delaware can build on what is now their largest lead.
Well, unfortunately for College of Charleston, Cameron Johnson just way too deep against that interior defense of Delaware. Point guards are better off unless they have a clear lane to the basket, pull up just inside the foul line.
Ends on a 7-0 run. Here's King Davis. Baseline. The smaller Bailey defends. His shot's blocked by Beru as he came over to help and shot in traffic. Here's Cheely off the rebound. Stopped by Holden. Inside the paint, Cheely draws some contact and gets the 4th foul of the second half against the head.
Well, that was a nice play by Cheely. He got Holden bumped, which created the separation. And then as Holden tried to recover, he saw a gap, step through it with his left foot and enabled him to draw the foul on Eric Carter, who was just out of position.
Carter's first. Cheely at the free throw line, where he shoots 76% on the season, second highest mark on the team. Missing the first, though. Joe Cheely, the sophomore from Orlando, averaging just under 14 points per game over the last 6 contests coming in, including that 17-point game against Delaware.
Cheely, a very intelligent player, plays at a great pace, but he also is so clever in that he wants to get to the foul line because he's such a good foul shooter and then finds ways to create that.
Shooter's touch on the road for Cheely as he went back iron, high off of the rim, and then falling back through. It's 41-38, Delaware on top by 3. 13:55 left as Corbett comes into the game. A break for Marvin King Davis. Smaller lineup now for Holden as he dribbles across the floor. Inside-out dribbles. Carter sets the screen. Driving on Cheely. Gets past him and scoops it up with the right hand. First field goal made for Corey Holden. He had 2 points from the line.
You win on those drives when your hips and shoulders are lower than your opponent's. That time Holden was able to turn the corner. Beru inexplicably did not come over and rotate to affect the shot.
Delaware up by 5 as Carter and Beru get tangled on the inside. Play continues to Barry in the corner. He drives baseline. Holden bumps him on the dribble drive. And that's foul number 5 against Delaware, the first on Corey Holden.
A lot of players don't realize that you can pressure the ball and challenge a shooter by having a small cushion. That time Holden just too close to him. And though Kenyon Barry is not overly quick, or certainly not as quick as Holden, but when you have the advantage of knowing which way you're going, he created the foul just because Holden was so closely aligned to him.
Cheely will trigger it in from the left side to Barry, who just drew the foul. Now Hayes in defense as they bring it back on top. Bailey, a couple seconds into the shot clock. They work it around the perimeter. Now it's Barry with the basketball. Hedging the screen is Carter. They go inside to Beru as there was just Holden and Anderson back to defend. A foul against one of those guards in the mix. And no, they're gonna. I had a 2 out of 3 chance when I said guards, but the third guy that was in the mix, Carter, actually gets called for the foul, his second.
Beru slipped the screen there. Nice recognition by Kenyon Barry to get him the ball.
Reset shot clock after the foul. Inbound goes to Barry. They'll flip it to Pat Brannon, who just entered the ball game. Second time we've seen him on the floor. Left open on the wing. Couple dribbles, holding defense. Trying to get inside to Brew. They do. Carter on his hip. Brew backing down the freshman. Brew, strong move. Up off the window, and he still has not missed. 4-4 from the field goes Brew, and he's got 8 points.
Though I know Brew is not a tremendous low post player, I still think with a young player and Carter on him, Delaware may want to run some help to assist him.
Here's Holden, taking it to the rim, this time using the left on the right side. Carter can't put it back through, but Holden sneaks back in and grabs the rebound after Carter's miss.
That's why it's so important to always block out the man who's driven the ball, whether he shoots it or not. He is the closest to the basket, and he realized it.
Here's Holden, has Baru on him. A couple crossovers, no look pass, corner. Corbett, smooth!
Corbett. So solid when he has time to set his feet, but what I love about him, he's got a great knee bend in terms of his preparation.
Here's Brandon. Can he answer with a three? No. Short off the side of the iron, and Holden will walk it up the floor. Under 12 to go. Delaware with a six-point lead thanks to Chavarsky. Corbett's ninth multiple three-point game of the season. It's Holden, turns the corner, clear path to the rim, and Delaware gets another bucket. They're up eight.
I think Coach Grant needs a timeout here. Delaware's gotten into a rhythm. Holden doing a great job of identifying where the weak side help is, and right now Baru has not been a factor at all challenging those shots.
Here's Barry, forces one, but hits with a hand in the face. Canyon Barry, that's a tough make. Drilled it from beyond the arc, and the lead is five now for Delaware.
Barry, such a smart player, realizes he needed to do something to help his team there, who was really laboring at the offensive end and very much a struggle at the defensive end.
And an illegal screen called against Eric Carter right in front of us, and that foul will take us to a timeout. We'll also give Kyle Anderson a chance to go visit Paul Lowry as he came up limping after the defensive effort against Canyon Barry. Delaware on top by five, 48-43, 11-13 left to play. Back in a moment.
Hello, Delaware fans. This is Coach Brock at beautiful Lums Pond State Park, just minutes from Delaware Stadium. I'm inviting you to come to the park, enjoy their year-round camping, boat rentals, equestrian center, and so much more. While you're here, experience the Go Ape Treetop Adventure. Go Ape is an outdoor experience where you can live life adventurously and experience the park from 50 feet up in the trees, hanging by a wire. To learn more about Go Ape or to book your visit to the course, visit www.goape.com. Go Hens.
Hold on to me as we go. Just know you're not alone. 'Cause I'm gonna make this place yours.
The Hens trailed 33-29 at the half. They now lead 48-43 here with 11-13 remaining in the contest. Want to remind our listeners that a portion of this broadcast brought to you by the American Spirit Federal Credit Union. And Bill, we talked about the intensity picked up for Delaware in this second half. And now shots starting to fall. Big shot by Canyon Barry a moment ago to get the lead back to only five for Delaware. But I think a lucky break that the media timeout was coming for Earl Grant's team because he didn't have to use one of his timeouts.
And a lot of coaches know that and will wait for that, but sometimes games can escape you. Had he not hit that shot, I think Delaware would have gone down and scored again. Now he's really behind the eight ball. And I think at times, yes, the optionality of timeouts late in the game is very important, but sometimes you've got to stem runs by teams, using even when the media timeout is very close.
11:05 left is Kyle Charleston with the basketball after the illegal screen was called by against Eric Carter before heading to break. Pickard in the game now. He defends on Bailey. Bailey driving. Kick out to Johnson. Johnson with 15 to shoot inside the paint. Bumped on his way to the rim. And that's a foul against Delaware. They're seven, so 1-1 now for Cameron Johnson. Johnson, 2-3 from the stripe today.
Unfortunately, Kesmyn Hayes, as he closed out, was a little off balance and not able to stay in front of Johnson as he made that penetration. Tried to slap from behind. You're almost always better off staying in front. If they're going to shoot a shot, shoot it over the outstretched arms, not put him in the 1-1 so early.
Johnson makes the first free throw. Correct myself, as that's the eighth foul against Delaware. The Cougars with four. Cameron Johnson tying Barry for a team-high 11 points. 11 points for Corbett leads Delaware. Hayes a point behind with 10. Johnson gets them both. And the lead for Delaware is three. 48-45 as Holder brings the ball up the floor. Chile on his hip. Flips it to Pinkert. Pinkert across the timer towards the three-point line. And back to Corey it goes.
And College of Charleston playing a little bit of zone here. They play it very infrequently. Little matchup it looks like to me, or a 2-3 architecture to start with.
Pinkert on top, over to Corbett. Corbett in double figures for back-to-back games. He had 12 against the Dukes. Holding on the dribble drive, hanging into traffic, lost grip of it. And luckily for the Hens, it'll stay Delaware basketball. Three to shoot as Charleston, after Holden dropped it, just couldn't pick it up and rolled out of bounds.
This has got to be a quick set play, as you mentioned. Only three to get out of bounds. They'll probably throw over the top and let Holden try to create. But he's got to recognize when an additional defender is coming towards him.
Here's Hayes, right side. Bounces it into King Davis. King Davis is fouled by Pierre. That's a good look and a great set play off the bench of Monte Roll.
Just a simple back screen in the middle of the lane. College of Charleston, I'm sure, has seen that. But a great call by Coach Ross there with only three left. Nice screen was set. They did not switch it. Baru got called on the screen, then was forced to foul as he came in to try to affect the shot.
King Davis at the stripe, one of one today. Makes that one, now two of two. King Davis, 31 points last game against James Madison. Only the fifth UD forward to score 30 points in a game over the last 20 seasons. One of them was here today, being honored at halftime, along with some other alum, Greg Smith. We saw a lot of former Delaware players here at the half. We'll talk about a little bit, some of them later in the broadcast as King Davis misses on the second, and back to Colin Charleston it goes.
I misspoke on the last foul. That was Pierre, the sub that was in, that had the foul.
Now Johnson gets in deep, too strong off the window. Ball is loose. Hayes can't track it down. He did touch it, though, before it went out of bounds. Originally called Colin Charleston's basketball. They're going to now signal that it's Delaware's, and then another reversal back to Collins of Charleston. That's not good communication between those officials.
No, and they ended up having to talk about it. The official out near the College of Charleston bench saw that Kasman Hayes, as he went to touch the ball, as he went to grab it.
They got it right, I believe.
Yes, they did.
And with 9:53 left, Charleston down by four with the basketball. Bailey right side, Pinkert guarding him. Couple of dribbles in the corner. It's Johnson trying to penetrate. Corbett cuts him off. Bailey, catch, shoot, three. He's made two. Can't get a third. And a rebound into the hands of Chavarsky Corbett.
And a good challenge there by Pinkert. His height really a factor on closing out those long-range shooters.
Here's Corbett. Can he do it again? Off the mark, strong. Long rebound. Hayes, an offensive board. He had five of those against the College of Charleston down in South Carolina on January 10th.
Athleticism and activity and intelligence of knowing where the ball is being missed to. That's Kasman Hayes.
Here's Holden slicing through off his feet, off the window, off the mark, into the hands of Canyon Barry. And he dribbles up the floor. Does not have numbers, but challenges Delaware at the rim and gets fouled. He'll go to the free throw line. We'll get to see. If you're watching on Hens All Access, you'll get to see it. But we'll describe Candy Barry from the free throw line. Shoots it just like his pops, underhanded.
You're absolutely right. And at times, an incredibly accurate way to do it. Very mechanically sound. Another player from that great Sixers team in the 60s, Dave Gambi, used to shoot them like that. Now, Barry uses an even stance. Some people actually use the staggered stances, which Gambi used.
He misses on the first, 68% from the free throw line. His father, the very famous Rick Barry, one of the all-time greats in the NBA, shot underhanded and did it to the tune of 90% from the free throw line.
I was going to say, I think the father had a better shooting percentage than his son.
That's third best all time. Barry misses both of them, and King Davis with a rebound. That's the third rebound for King Davis.
Baru inserted back in the game for some interior defense.
Holden on top. Anderson, after getting his foot wrapped on the bench, came out for a few moments to do that. Now back in with the basketball. King Davis sets the screen. Anderson on the drive, challenges Baru over the 6'9" center, missing, and Barry with another rebound. Candy Barry, the second leading rebounder on the team.
Barry does a great job of getting position, but what I like about him is he rebounds outside his area, always very active in going to the misses.
And now we'll foul away from the ball. That will do it for Terrence O'Donohue, who hasn't played more than 7 minutes in the game after starting And he picks up his fifth foul.
O'Donohue tried to post up in the middle of the lane, had Pinkert on his back, but instead of just having his arms outstretched, fingers to the sky, he actually rotated his shoulders and caught Pinkert. Pinkert doing the best he could to defend. That's a play that a young player's got to understand. I already have great position. I don't have to do any more to improve it.
Delaware now with the basketball. They led by 8 just 3 minutes ago. Now lead by 4. A chance to up that lead once again as the scoring for both of these teams has slowed down a bit. College of Charleston has made just 2 of their last 10. Delaware all of their last 4, 2 of their last 8. Both teams to their bench as the College of Charleston able to make a substitution. Delaware will be able to do the same. After O'Donohue fouls out, again, the officiating crew going to the monitors, though. And as much as, and we talked about this earlier, so we won't harp on it for too much more, there is rarely anything found out. If you didn't see it the first time in real time, it probably didn't happen.
He's just looking to see if O'Donohue swung the arm and caught Devon Pinkert in the face. I think that's what will constitute the flagrant here. I didn't see that. I saw it was a very physical post-up. I thought the officials did a good job of making the call right away, not to allow any further contact where you might have an incident on your hands. So I know they're supposed to do this. The assigners tell them they need to, and the supervisors get in and get more detail. But again, the disruption of the game to me, especially at this point, is significant.
What it does, though, is Holden is on the bench and Anthony Mosley in the game, allows Holden to get some more real-time minutes of getting a breather, because he plays a lot of minutes as Corey Holden. So he'll be able to get a little bit of a break as they continue to look at the monitor. Let's get you a Glasgow Medical Aid Unit's scoreboard update with location in Glasgow, Christiana, and Middletown. Save time, save money, get well. Visit them online at GlasgowMedicalCenter.com. Nothing going on right now in the CAA, so we'll take you around the top 25 as we got a close one at DePaul, number 7, Villanova, tied 41-41 against DePaul. Kansas taking care of Kansas State, 48-34. 11 minutes left in that contest. Iowa State over TCU, 64-51. 7 minutes left in that game. Marquette and first-year head coach Steve Wojciechowski up by 4 over 25th-ranked Butler, 47-43. Wisconsin won earlier in the day over Iowa, 74-63. West Virginia took care of Texas Tech earlier in the day, 77-58. Notre Dame, 8th-ranked team in the country, falls to Pittsburgh, 76-72. Starting at 4 o'clock, a big matchup in the ACC, North Carolina and Louisville. Number 1, Kentucky will host Alabama. And tonight, Virginia, number 2-ranked team in the country, undefeated at 19-0, host the Duke Blue Devils.
And another score of significance, certainly for Phil Martelli Jr. His father had a terrific win at home over Davidson, who came in with a 14-4 record, 5-2 in the A-10, and a nice 75-70 win for Phil Martelli Sr.
We mentioned Kentucky undefeated, Virginia undefeated. Martelli knows a thing or two about going undefeated in the regular season. They did that with Jameer Nelson, Delonte West. That was when St. Joseph's would come to Bob Carpenter Center and play at the earlier parts of last decade. Now it's still a delay here as we go through the national scores. Again, nothing going on in the CAA, but maybe more serious this time because it's a very long delay here. You would hope something gets called extra after the stoppage.
Well, there certainly should be, but they're going back to the monitor again. And I just don't understand this. If you don't have the angle, you're not going to invent an angle because this is not a TV game, and there's only so much you can have. And I think this is over-officiating here.
But it looks like a flagrant foul will be the call as Pinkert going to step up to the free throw line. Because Pinkert was fouled, the person that was fouled, I assume, is why he has to shoot the free throw. Otherwise, you wouldn't select Pinkert, who's 10 of 21 on the season from the free throw line, shooting 48% to shoot this.
Yes, but they're still adjudicating over there, and I think this crew, we had a replacement on this crew. We were supposed to have Gladden involved. He was not here today for some reason, so there may be some just not miscommunications, but just a lot of work that these officials have to do with each other to make sure they get the call correct.
So it's the 2 shots for Devon Pinkert, who shoots just 48% on the season from the free throw line, missing on the first, and for such a good shooter, that's concentration. for Devon Pinker.
Well, he is too good a shooter. He uses a staggered stance, and if you watch his back, he kind of arches back and ends up on his heels a little bit. I think they'll study some film, but Pinkert's too good an athlete not to be shooting 70 or 75%. I love his stroke from long range. He gets great rotation on the ball, always holds his follow through.
So O'Donohue out of the game with five fouls, plus the flagrant there. It was Pinker making one of two on that trip, but Delaware back up by five with the basketball, 50-45. On top, it's Pinker, and a foul away from the ball against Delaware this time. Gives it to College of Charleston.
This is as much off the ball calling that I've seen in a long time. Now, there may be stuff going on, and I'm a big fan of that because a lot of teams do things off the ball to create separation, but here they're going back to the monitor again.
I haven't seen anything like this as far as going to the monitor, away from the ball, delaying the game, delaying the tempo, and you can hear the roar of the Bob Carpenter Center crowd. Good crowd on hand, by the way, I'll say that. Because they're frustrated just as we are, just as our listeners, I'm sure, are, just as the viewers on Hens All Access are, that the flow of the game is being stopped by this officiating crew that can't seem to get it right live. And sometimes, you know, even as a broadcaster, when you film things, you want to pretend as if it's live. For the referees, call the game as if it's live, as if you don't have a chance to go to the monitors and just call it as you see.
I don't really have a great explanation other than maybe this crew has not worked together. This has been a physical game off the ball. Call it appropriately. Get it right as best you can in real time. Use the monitor only to support if you think you didn't see it at all. But I would say if you didn't see it all, how come you're calling it off the ball so much? There's been a lot of this. O'Donohue had three fouls off the ball. Delaware's had a couple. We had Eric Carter get a screening foul right in front of us. I think they've been very adamant about establishing the fact that they're going to call moving screens and off the ball violations more heavily in this game. That's been established. Now call it and let's move on to the game.
We will move on now as nothing was seen extracurricular, just a personal foul against Chavarsky Corbett. His first, team's 10th though, so the Cougars in the double bonus. With 8:17 left. Entry pass looking for Beru. It went through the lane, actually, into the hands of Gilmore as Beru missed it, but Gilmore dropped it out of bounds and back to Delaware.
Devon Pinkert actually upset with himself. He was on the weak side and hadn't gotten around to locate the ball soon enough. He might have been able to make the steal, but I continue to mention the fact that Pinkert's insertion in the game really improves the off-the-ball defense of Delaware.
Here's Holden now. Screen comes from King Davis. Now Beru defense. Holden double team comes with Johnson. Back to Anderson. Under 8 minutes to go. Delaware on top by five. Holden inside out dribble. Pass Beru. Kicks it out. Corbett lines up the three. Off the mark. Around and out. Into the hands of Beru. That was a clean look.
That was a great play by Holden driving in. He drew the shot blocker to him and the help into the lane. Kicks it out to a wide open Corbett.
Holden has seven assists, nearly got his eighth there. Instead, it's Beru this time on the left block working against King Davis. He's had success against King Davis. Pinker doubles. Chile, extra pass, Barry. Anderson puts a hand up in his face. Barry misses, but an offensive rebound by Ajay Beru resets it to Chile.
That was a good block out by Marvin King Davis on Beru. The ball was missed so badly by Barry, it rebounded out almost to the foul line, and Beru able to run it down with those long arms.
Fifth offense rebound of the game for the College of Charleston. Delaware has seven of them. Inside it goes to Gilmore. Gilmore working on Pinkert. Shot over Pinkert. Too strong. Gilmore follows the shot along the baseline and is held up. He'll shoot two free throws when we come back. 7:03 left. Delaware leads by five. It's 50-45. Back in a moment on 94.7 WTSD.
We are the champions. Welcome to the other land of dreamers, brothers, sisters, others. Yeah, we all fight like that.
You can now watch all Hens All Access content on any of your devices. Whether you're at the store on your phone or on the couch with your iPad or laptop, Hens All Access live and on-demand content is just a touch away. Not only will live games be available on your mobile devices, they'll also be available in high definition. Best of all, you don't even need an app. Just click over to BlueHens.com on your device and take the Hens anywhere you go.
Welcome back to the Bob Carpenter Center. A portion of this broadcast presented by Concord Pet Foods and Supplies. For everything your pet needs, visit ConcordPetFoods.com. Delaware leads it by 5, 50-45. They trail by as many as 10 in the first half. They've led by as many as 8. The flow over the last 4 minutes or so due to some stoppages, hard to find some tempo. But right now, Delaware, which had some momentum, trying to defend. And it leaves with Charleston at the free throw line when we come back. Delaware, 10 fouls. The Cougars, only 6.
I think when you're a home team and you're in rhythm, you want the game to continue at the best possible flow without a lot of disruptions. That's why coaches on the road will use their timeouts, and they'll use a lot of subs just to try to get the rhythm broken by a team. And I think these stoppages here, even though I know the officials are trying to get it right, I think it has affected the game somewhat here in the second half.
Gilmore misses the free throw. 1 of 3 today. 0 of 3 from the field goes Gilmore. This is a freshman that leads the team, shooting 59% from the field coming in. So Delaware's done a nice job against the freshman from Greensboro, former CA Rookie of the Week, after a great start to his college career. That one flat. Gilmore misses the second one. A nice box out by Jeffers. Gets it to Holden. Delaware up by 5. Holding a couple crossovers. Freshman on freshman matchup as he's defended by Cameron Johnson. Brings it over to the left side. Anderson. Top of the key. 20 to shoot. Over to Pinkert. Pinkert looking to pass out. It's Jeffers at the foul line. Here's Anderson working hard to get open. Guarded by the freshman Johnson. Now Corbett. 12 to shoot for Delaware. Inside to Jeffers. Jeffers working in the paint. Poked away by Baru. Jeffers gets it back. Turns, fires, and hits.
Boy, he did a nice job there. After the ball was poked by Baru, he immediately gathered it in, turned to his left shoulder, and rose up. That shot had more arc than a miss he had earlier in the game. I really like Jeffers. He is very intense in this game and very focused.
Jeffers now 3 of 6 as Johnson dribbles his way inside and draws the foul. 6:18 left. Delaware up by 7. Maurice Jeffers, after that one, 7 points. He's averaging 7 points per game at the Bob Carpenter Center this season, just 4 points per game on the road. So he likes these friendly home rims. Johnson, though, at the free throw line after the foul called against Corbett.
You know, one thing Delaware would love to do is get a couple of stops in a row to build some momentum, and obviously to expand a potential lead. If you're scoring at your other end, you need to get some stops. But College of Charleston continues to run their stuff pretty well. They have been driving the ball at good angles to get inside and affect Delaware. And Delaware's mounted up a number of fouls here because they have been unable to contain the dribbler and keep him out of the lane.
And Johnson makes both free throws. You don't want to put Charleston on the free throw line because they've been struggling. They've made just 2 of their last 12 from the field, but able to stay in it because of some timely free throw shooting. Although Charleston as a team just 7 of 14 overall today. Holding over to Pinkert as Delaware has it back on offense. 16 to shoot. Corbett from the corner, too strong. And a rebound on the left side.
Not a bad look, but unfortunately no offensive rebounders on the weak side there.
Now Cheely driving, left his feet, bounced the pass into the hands of Corbett, and a steal by the freshman gives it back to Delaware. Here's Holden, couple of crossover moves, getting inside, and Cheely called for the foul. That's the 7th on the Cougars, so a 1-on-1 coming up for Corey Holden.
Well, Cheely made a mistake there and allowed Holden to get into the lane, going down the left side with his left hand. Holden is very capable with both hands, but extremely quick and able to get to the basket with his left hand. Plus, he uses that right side of his body to ward people off.
Holden, front end good. 3 of 3 from the free throw line is Corey Holden. He's got 7 points to match 7 assists. Holden shooting 82% from the line over the last 7 games. 50 of his last 60, and now 50 of his last 61. As he misses that shot, Delaware on top, 53-47.
College of Charleston has been able to penetrate both ways, but they have not been going into the post here since Adonihue fouled out.
Here's Barry penetration and another foul against Delaware. This time against Kyle Anderson, putting Canyon Berry, who's 0-2 back on the stretch.
Canyon Berry using his right hand, and he's done it four times in this game. Drives from the top of the key down the right side. If Delaware can either help in from the perimeter or level off that drive and force him to his left hand, I think they might be a little bit more successful of keeping him out of the lane.
Berry makes the free throw. Youngest son by 20 years of Hall of Famer Rick Berry. College of Charleston has not made a shot from the floor since the 11:32 mark of this game. We're now at 5:21. But Berry makes both free throws, 4 points in a row for the College of Charleston, and Delaware's lead is four.
College of Charleston has employed somewhat of a passive, a 2-2-1 press. It really is designed to be disruptive to the flow of Delaware and to Holden, not really to create turnovers.
Approaching 5 minutes left from the Bob Carpenter Center. Holden over to Anderson. Kyle Anderson with 9 points on the contest. Pinkert, a contested three, hand in the face. Doesn't matter, Canyon Berry. As Pinkert gets the lead back up to seven.
Reverse the court, and then the pass gets right back. Berry too slow to close out.
Cheely dribbles in, dumps it to Baru. Another foul on Delaware. And Alajai Baru will go to the free throw line. Going back to Devon Pinkert. He doesn't score double figures a whole lot, although he did have 12 points against James Madison. But it seems in the month of January, at least, every shot he's hit has been a meaningful shot.
He certainly has, and that comes with confidence not only from himself, but his teammates and the staff to put him in positions and also to expand his playing time. Yes, he struggled early on in the season. It may have just been some sophomore-itis, so to speak, but I think he's really risen up. It started with his defense. He's a fine rebounder, a good passer. Now he's starting to add that scoring component, and I really love the rotation on his shot. He will become an excellent long-range shooter.
Bruce splits a pair. Delaware up 56-50. Before that make by Pinkert, and what makes it a big shot is Delaware had made just one of their last seven prior to Pinkert letting it go. Holding in the corner right side. Needs some help. Bounces it out to Anderson near half court. 18 to shoot for Delaware. Anderson points out things on the offense. King Davis looking to pass from the extended foul line right. Here's Pinkert to Anderson, seven to shoot. Inside to King Davis. Baru on his back, gets called for the foul. 1-on-1 coming up for MKD.
That was nice recognition by Kyle Anderson. After Marvin King Davis set the down screen for Anderson, he immediately returned the favor by dumping it into him. He caught Baru off balance. And that was, I think, some consistency. Not a makeup call, but Delaware's been getting called for those physical plays down there. That time Baru bumped Marvin King Davis on the catch.
King Davis smoothly makes the first free throw, really shooting well from the stripe over the last two games. King Davis shooting well from everywhere, 61% from the field over his last four games, although just 2 of 6 today. He makes both free throws and a lead up to 8 for the Blue Hens.
Is it like any activity that you do? When you do more of it, when you put yourself in a position to get fouled, get to the foul line more, as long as you've got a good stroke, which he does, that will result in much better efficiency, and that's what we're getting from Marvin King Davis right now.
Cheely to Berry off the curl. That's an illegal screen. Another foul away from the ball. This time the third against Ajay Baru. And Delaware has the basketball back as Holden will re-enter. He left momentarily.
Now, I was watching that play, so I had a great view. That was a fine call. Baru made the cardinal sin. Once you set your screen, you cannot move. Kyle Anderson was on the outside hip of Canyon Berry trailing him. He should not get picked there, and he did. The only reason he did was because Baru moved on him.
Kyle Anderson has to call a timeout as he could not get the basketball in. We'll take a break with him. 4:09 remaining in this one. 58-50. Delaware leads by 8.
Delaware Athletics sponsors 21 teams comprised of over 600 student-athletes and will award nearly 230 scholarships costing $9.5 million this year. Blue Hen fans across the nation contribute to the University of Delaware Athletic Fund each year. Your contributions provide scholarships, equipment, and academic support so UD student-athletes can compete in the sport they love and receive a college education.
Rush hour or relax hour? It's your choice. Dark. Moving forward.
We have the pieces. Now it's time to bring them together. Every dribble and every rep turns into every point and every win. It's winning time again. Experience it.
Here at the Bob Carpenter Center, I'm Scott Klatskin alongside Bill Harbin. Ronnie Vickers producing back in the WDSG studios. Balanced scoring attack for the Hens, who lead by 8:58-50. 11 points for Corbett, 10 for Hayes, 9 for Anderson, 8 for King Davis, 7 for Holden and Jeffers, 6 points for Devon Pinkard. Just splitting up the scoring throughout. For College of Charleston, they're led by Johnson with 14, Barry with 13, 9 for Baru.
I think that's what makes Delaware now become more difficult to defend. You have so many people contributing. The shots are spread out. Nobody has taken any more than 9 shots, which is Holden. And I think that is really significant here. They're sharing the ball. The coaches have developed a nice rhythm into their substitution patterns.
Anderson, after the timeout, throws it into King Davis. King Davis will take a couple dribbles and find Holden, who will walk the ball up the floor after the timeout. Pressure. Crosses half court to King Davis. Now Hayes on the wing, trying to get it back to Holden. Face guarding is Johnson, but Holden gets the handoff with 22 to shoot.
Zone trap by College of Charleston. Good job trying to trap Marvin King Davis, but he operated out of it.
Backdoor Anderson, the 8th assist for Holden, and Kyle Anderson soars for the two-hand finish.
Boy, if you haven't seen that play from the University of Delaware, you're not doing your job in the film room. That's a backdoor with the help cleared up at the high elbow. A great delivery by Holden.
Baru challenging King Davis. King Davis gets a piece into the hands of Hayes. Delaware, their largest lead. It's 60-50, under 4 to play.
And a nice challenge there by Marvin King Davis going straight up and not jumping in or getting caught off balance there to affect Baru's shot.
Here's Anderson on top to Pinkard. Gilmore defense, gets closer. Pinkard puts it on the deck to the rim. Pinkard into the body of Baru, draws the foul. We'll take a break with 3:11 left in Delaware up by double digits. Back in a moment.
Hey fans, 12 and younger. Do you want to be a future Blue Hen? Join the Future Hens Club presented by St. Francis Healthcare for invites to exclusive events and free admission to select UD games.
Meet coaches and players like us.
Get your official Future Hens t-shirt and more surprises.
To join, log on bluehens.com with a parent, click on Fan Zone, then Kids Club. Click Register Here, fill out your information, and click Submit.
Join today!
We have the pieces. Now it's time to bring them together. Every dribble and every rep turns into every point and every win. It's winning time again. Experience it.
Here at the Bob Carpenter Center, Delaware trying to pick up their fourth win in CAA competition. It would be their second against the College of Charleston, a team they beat back on January 10th moments ago. We know Kyle Anderson for his three-point shooting attack, 2 of 5 today, 251 career three-pointers made, most all time at Delaware. But how about the dunk? It's that backdoor play that they run on the left side.
They lift the help on the ball side. The post player comes off the low block, lifts up to the elbow. Corey Holden turns the corner as if he's going to attack or split and kick. Kyle Anderson gets a lot of no help off of him in the corner. That means the defender is almost face guarding him. Anderson, very quick, back doors. Holden delivers a perfect left-hand pass. There's no help there to affect the shot, and he finishes with the dunk. That's a play they've run time and time again, and it seems to be, for whatever reason, Scott, more successful on the left side than a few times they've run it on the right. And it may be, as you told me at the break, maybe the delivery ability of Holden with the left hand, and that's probably it.
Pinkard stepping up, making 2 free throws. He's now made his last 3 from the stripe. Struggled this season for the free throw line, but it hits big shots there. As Chile gets inside, on top to Bailey on the kick out. Front rim, no. And into the hands of Kyle Anderson. He's double teamed, passes out to Hayes. Hens up by 12 with the basketball.
17 points in the second half allowed by Delaware. This is the best defense they've played in the entire season in terms of team defense, helping out, rebounding, extra help, rotating the ball, and affecting and challenging shots.
Here's Hayes, I agree with you. Hens let up 88 against James Madison, 92 against Eli, just 50 today against the Cougars so far. 2:32 left. Corner, Anderson, and Anderson does it from the corner. Hens go up 15.
He loves to rotate his hips back to his right side coming off that down pin.
Now Chile with a left-handed layup. A lot of contact, no whistles. The crowd was excited. I thought maybe I missed a whistle, but Chile gets through. And the Hens lead is 13 now, approaching the two-minute mark. Full court pressure, inbound goes to King Davis. Dribble handoff to Pinkerton in a tough spot in the corner. Back to King Davis, 31 on the shot clock. Hayes with 4 seconds to get it across at 28. Beats the timer at 27. Dribbles into a corner, though. And a tie-up gives the basketball back to College of Charleston. Not a great place to dribble once you get across half court for Kasman Hayes.
You are right. The positioning is not quite as good as you would like, but worse yet, Kasman, when he was doubled, put the ball right over his head. What you want to do is rip it and try to step through. It goes over your head and shoulders as a last-ditch precaution.
Just the eighth turnover of the game for Delaware, and there's Evan Bailey again. Quickly, 5 straight points for the College of Charleston as Bailey knocks in his third three-pointer. Lead down to 10 for the Hens.
Full court pressure here, a man on the ball. Delaware could run out if they wanted to or use Marvin King Davis because Beru's playing safe off of him.
Holden gets across half court, beats a double team. Ball fake, kick out to Monte Ross, but he's not in uniform, so a turnover again for the Hens. Going a little fast as they got the lead up to 15 and just need to relax. There's only a minute, 22 left, Bill.
Two small things. Corey should never pass when he's up in the air, though I know he does and sometimes successful, but not in that situation. And don't drive the ball so deep when you're ahead. You're in the 10 shot, you've got timeouts.
And now the clock will stop. Canyon Berry will be able to cut into this Delaware lead with the clock at 1:14. A foul called beyond the arc as Marvin King Davis came out the hedge of screen.
Though you do not want to allow any threes in this situation, you also can't allow the driver to be fouled. You don't want to foul him because that stops the clock. I mean, I know it's so obvious, and that's easier said than done sometimes from here. But once you've run them off the three cushion, try to send them to bad spots. Don't body them and allow the clock to be stopped and then score with it.
Berry, two underhanded free throws, good. He's made his last four from the stripe, and now set up in full court pressure. Inbound goes to King Davis with the Hens up 65-57. Pinkard at the foul line, puts it on the floor. Couple of dribbles, trap comes, sends out 3 seconds.
They need a timeout.
Now two, Pinkard, I thought got it across, but did not. Monte Ross says the 10-second violation is called. Speaking with the officiating crew, he's saying that he called just what you were calling for, a timeout. Shot clock showing 25. And Monte saying that he called a timeout. I believe that at least is the discussion, Bill.
And I hope that is the discussion. It should be awarded. Now, for this official to be that efficient right at the clock, he crossed it as it was changing. That's going to be a tough call. I think they're going to award the timeout. Yes,
they
are.
And they do.
A smart decision by the crew.
Yeah, Delaware. Of course it was a smart decision. You were calling for it, Bill. 65-57, 63 seconds left. I like the timeout. One, it saves possession for Delaware, but I think Delaware could use a timeout. There's three left, and just talk things over. Hey, guys, we've turned the basketball over the last couple of possessions. Let's take care of the rock. Let's wind the clock down. Let's get out of here with our second win of the season against the Cougars.
College of Charleston needs to preserve the clock, so they need to extend and foul. They need to double and then foul you right away because they can ill afford 10, 15 seconds to run off. Delaware, on the other hand, knows that. So why penetrate to where you might take it into a bad place? You don't want to get caught up in the air. Worst case is you get in a double team. 5-second call could happen, but you've got timeouts to use. Delaware has two timeouts. Now they have the arrow, so a lot of things here favoring them. And this is where it's important with a young team that you coach these situations in practice, but also really coach them during the game. And Corey Holden's got to understand about when and where to penetrate and not to leave his feet in those situations. I know sometimes you've got to make the right pass, and he's very capable of that, but not here in the end game where you've got the clock, timeouts, and the possession arrow in your favor.
Holden gets it off the inbound. Across half quarter trying to do so as Chile bumps him, and Holden will shoot what now will be a two-shot foul.
And here Holden very intelligently knows that. He dribbles the ball across. They had 10 seconds to get it over. It's under a minute, and he creates the foul by smart offensive basketball.
Free throw here will stop a College of Charleston 7-0 run. If Holden can knock one through, he'll get two tries. And he does not make the first. Holden 7 points, 2 of 9 from the field, 3 of 5 now from the free throw line, but 8 assists for Holden, who now over the last 7 games up to 45 assists.
He's played so intelligently. He's so willing to share the ball with his teammates. At times he dribbles it a lot, but he really is dribbling it to set up his teammates. And then he has the ability to attack the lane and rise up and take hits and score. A very smart young player.
Holden makes a second free throw, setting up full court pressure. Now Hayes with a steal. Can't track it down along the baseline. And it'll go back to Collins of Charleston.
And what a smart play by Kasman Hayes. And a lot of young players might have tried to save the ball there, but if he had saved it, A, he would have saved it to College of Charleston. B, he would have been 25 feet away, and they would have had a 5-on-4. So nice, good defense there by Kasman Hayes.
And avoided what could have been injury for Kasman Hayes as Johnson drives, misses. Baru puts it back up and through. 40 seconds left. Delaware up 66-59.
I love the fact there that Devon Pinker did not foul Baru. He didn't have an opportunity to foul him on the floor, so he just let him make the two. That keeps them from getting to the foul line for an additional point.
Holden passing to King Davis. And a whistle as just too many players in the area. Baru, I think, accidentally reached in and bumped Marvin King Davis. As Delaware was in a bit of trouble trying to get the ball up the floor. That's a fifth on Baru. Baru fouled out of the game against Delaware back on the 10th of this month, and he'll do so again today.
You're right. Delaware did not have great spacing there. They had two players close together where they could be double-teamed very easily without running someone off. Spacing, organization, and maybe a little bit more passing versus this zone trap than the dribbling, which allows the zone to catch up.
Delaware leads 66-59. It'll be Marvin King Davis at the free throw line shooting a two-shot balanced scoring effort for Delaware. Anderson leads everybody with 14 points for the Blue Hens. High scorer for the College of Charleston, Canyonberry with 15, but 10 for Hayes, 11 for Corbett, 8 for King Davis, Pinkard with 8, Holden with 8. Chance for King Davis to get into double figures here from the free throw line and put this one away with 32.7 remaining. Hens trail by 10 in the first half. King Davis' first free throw is good. Davis 5 of 6 from the free throw line.
And this is how you close out games. You get your people to the foul line. You take as good a care of the basketball as you can. It's gotten a little harried. And then you've got to get back and defend without fouling.
King Davis misses a second. Barry kick out to Bailey. He has 3 threes. Can't make a fourth. Tipped around and into the hands of Johnson, who puts it back up and through. A timeout taken by Earl Grant. Not giving up yet are the Cougars, down 67-61, 22.2 remaining. Delaware, you got to like their chances. We've seen crazier things, though, happen on this court with College of Charleston and Delaware in action. If you go back to last year, Delaware trailed by 20 with 8 minutes left. I think this might be even crazier if College of Charleston can do a comeback with 22 seconds left.
The only thing College of Charleston has in their advantage is they have 3 timeouts remaining in order to stop the clock and get reorganized, but they've got to be able to score it. Delaware goes to the foul line and makes their next 2 sets of foul shots. There's just no way there are enough possessions for College of Charleston. The only thing Delaware's got to do is no threes. Don't allow any threes, because that's the only way the College of Charleston can get back in the game. And then, obviously, don't turn it over deep in your end. Take the 10-second or call a timeout if you're in trouble.
Hens 10 of 15 from the stripe this half, 16 of 22 overall. Both teams in the double bonus. Gilmore will challenge the inbounder, Corey Holden. He can run the baseline if he needs to. He'll start on the right side, though. Throws it into King Davis in the corner. Back to Holden. Ahead to Pinkard. Pinkard to Hayes. Hayes was going to put the exclamation point on the win, but the foul called against Bailey as Pinkard got the pass off in transition, and Pinkard can try to put this one away.
I think Kasman Hayes would have gone ahead and dunked it. He might have been better off since there was no defender back, dribbling the ball out to the corner and running another 6 seconds off probably before he would get fouled. I know that seems hard to do, but as a player, you want to think about these things, because all we want to do, Delaware, is to run the clock down where they have not enough time, even with timeouts remaining, to be able to get enough possessions to score.
How about Devon Pinkard, Bill? And that's a good point you make. Four straight free throws made from Pinkard. He came into this game shooting 48%. He missed his first free throw, and now five in a row for Devon Pinkard. Hens up by eight, 17 seconds left.
I couldn't be happier for Devon Pinkard because I think he at one time had lost confidence in his game, and he has really rebuilt himself, and he did it at the defensive end. He realized that was where he could contribute most. When you're not shooting well, go do something else to help your team. And he didn't let that aspect of his game affect him overall. And now he's rebuilt his shot. He's playing confidently. He's getting way more minutes. And he's been a major factor in their wins. And even at the loss at JMU, I thought he played extremely well.
He certainly did. 12 points for Pinkard. Double figures today as well with 10 after the free throws. Holden with a foul at 13.9. Put Chile at the line. He just made both of his free throws. So still a six-point lead for Delaware.
Delaware should run out, throw it deep, or just make sure they get it in.
They lob it into Marvin King-Davis, who's fouled with 13.2. And now King-Davis a chance to get the lead back up to three possessions.
Well, Marvin King-Davis, you couldn't ask for a guy who's really, I think, gotten better here at the start of the second half of the season. That tremendous game down at JMU. But I also like the other stuff he's doing. He always hustles back on defense at 6'7", even though he is very physically strong and also a good athlete. He's been asked to guard much taller people, and he's done more than an adequate job. He's very aggressive on the offensive and defensive glass, and he does a nice job of getting out and hedging as well. So he's improved his overall game, not to mention the ability to step up and make that mid-range shot and also finish at the basket.
King Davis makes the first, does so again on the second. Delaware making free throws down the stretch, 13 of 18 in this second half, and they lead 71-63. Now 11 seconds left for College Charleston. Barry gets to the rim and lays it up with 5.7 remaining. Delaware up by six, 71-65. Holden looking for someone to throw it into. Ball deflected by Chile. It goes right back out of bounds. And now Holden will inbound it from the baseline but can't move this time around.
Now, they might be better off with Pinkard taking the ball in. He's taller. Let Holden move because he's also a terrific foul shooter. If they're going to foul here, they really don't have a chance to win with 5-7 as long as Delaware gets it in.
Now Pinkard going to throw a baseball pass deflected into the hands of Joe Chile. He'll fire up a three. Hits it, but with 1.3, Earl Grant going to call a timeout. And Kyle Charleston has a chance. 1.3 left. The baseball pass thrown by Pinkard was deflected. Kyle Charleston got the steal, made the three, and here we are with 1.3. If Kyle Charleston can steal it just as they did, they'll have a chance to tie it up.
They're going over to look at the monitor, I believe, to see if it was a three-point shot. The Delaware staff, and maybe the time as well. I thought they were questioning the three. I saw Jeff Rafferty kind of pointing. Now maybe it was at the clock.
But Delaware, all they have to do, and we've been here before with Delaware down the stretch. You remember back that UNCW game at Trask Coliseum where it's easy to say for us all the Hens have to do is get the ball in bounds. But here we are again, end of a basketball game. All Delaware has to do is get the ball in bounds. That time stolen away. I don't know if that was the right decision for Pinkard. He saw Holden streaking, but the ball deflected on the baseball pass. You have two timeouts left. If you can't get it in, maybe use one of them. But here you're in the huddle, are the Hens, and Monte's got to be telling that to his team. Two timeouts left. If you can't get the basketball in, if you don't have a for sure pass in bounds, then call a timeout, and we'll draw something else up.
You've set the scene perfectly. The thing that I was looking at was how close Pinkard was to the inline. You've got 3 feet, step back, so if you do want to throw it long, no matter how high that guy jumps, and he had a 6'4" guy on him, he will be able to throw the ball over the top. I know that's what he was trying to do. He obviously wasn't trying to have it get deflected into the front court. He was trying to throw it all the way down. But very important here that Delaware, all they got to do is enter the ball. That is the key thing, and then make one foul shot.
Just get the ball inbounds is the message. It's Anderson. King Davis has been the recipient of many of these inbound passes. He has a taller frame and has been able to flash to the basketball. Holden, Pinkard, and Hayes on the floor. Earl Grant drawing things up. They have to get a steal and a three-point shot off.
And they're still looking at the monitor to somehow get this, either whether it's the time or the three correct.
Hens All Access crew with several different angles that the officials are looking at. They always do a great job here with a great staff that Jimmy Smith and Nina Raspa have.
Scott, I think they should send part of their check here to Jimmy Smith and his team, or make a donation, because they've used the monitor as much as any officiating crew that we've seen all season long.
That's absolutely correct. I assumed it was to look at the time at 1.3, because I thought it was a three-point shot for sure from Chile. But
well, I did too, but they've spent so much time looking at this that the time element, you would think they would get much more quickly, would you not?
I would think everything they've done today over the monitor, they would be able to do much quicker, Bill. But here we are again. What it comes down to, though, Delaware 1.3 seconds away from winning their fourth game in seven outings, playing better basketball as we turn the corner of the CAA schedule. The Hens have scored 80 points the last three games coming into this one. And in this contest, we ask of Delaware pregame to step it up defensively, and they do just that. Kyle Charleston, although they shot 48% from the field, just 39% in the second half, 9 of 23, and they shot 3 of 10 from three-point range. Obviously, 2 of 9 before that last make by Joe Chile. Hens forced 12 turnovers for the College of Charleston. I thought the intensity was there the whole night defensively.
There are a lot of ways analytically to study defenses, and so many coaches use shooting percentage, but I'm going to use the eye test tonight, this afternoon. I thought it was the activity level. I thought the help was better. They did have a little trouble controlling the dribbler, letting him get in, but they got out and contested the threes. I thought that they hedged much better than they did against JMU. I thought their off-the-ball defense, they changed up a couple times, ran some an additional defender at Baru to affect his shot. Devon Pinker continues to impress me with his off-the-ball and help defense. And they just seem to be more focused, locked into the scouting report this afternoon, and not allowed, at least College of Charleston had to work so hard for every opportunity.
And it's almost comical. Delaware has now broken huddle three or four times, still waiting for this officiating crew to make a decision. What they're looking at, I can't tell you. It's one of two things, obviously. We said it was the three ball or the time. If they come out of this, and it's 1.3 right now, and after this huge delay, put something like 1.4 or 1.5 on the clock, then there's a problem with this whole system, as there may be, regardless of what happens.
Well, these are the things where I believe the tape of the game should be studied by officials. I'm sure they do their homework that way. I know the coaches and the teams look at tape. They've got to see that this was not conducive to a well-played game, and I think both teams competed hard. It's been very disruptive. I'm actually impressed that both teams have kept their composure and the coaching staff just kind of dealing with these disruptions.
Hens back in the huddle, and they seem, for what it's worth, very relaxed as we go into this final play call. Delaware just has to trigger it in. To recap this game for you, Delaware trailed by 10 in the first half, led by 8 in the second half. College of Charleston battling back just a moment ago, got a steal off an inbound. Shot what we believe is a three-pointer to go down by 3. And they're going to put 1.1 on the clock. That is unbelievable. We just took 5 minutes to take off 0.2 of a second here at the Bob Carpenter Center. For whatever it's worth, again, all Delaware has to do is inbound the basketball, and they'll be 4-6 in the CAA, 5-16 overall.
Now he can run along the baseline. He should use his three-foot spacing back there and be sure that we can run somebody down from the weak side off of a screen and not have a foul.
Pinker tosses it in to Corey Holden, and Delaware beats College of Charleston for the second time this season. The Hens improve to 4-6 in conference play. A 71-68 victory here at the Bob Carpenter Center. We'll take a timeout when we come back. It's the American Spirit post-game show brought to you by the American Spirit Federal Credit Union in Newark, Middletown, and Dover, and online at americanspirit.org. Back in a moment as the Hens win their fourth game in their last seven. Back in a moment on 94.7 WDSD.